Good morning, good morning, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. Welcome to episode number 16 of Live Streams with Famous Friends. I am your host, Jason McNamara, and sitting over this side, my friend in New Zealand couldn't make it today, Mr. David Birch. He's back at work under a small temporary ability because New Zealand's doing very well with the situation going on. But over here, we have Mr. Paul Marshall, a.k.a. Neanderthal, over in Phoenix, Arizona. How you going, Paul?
How are you, Jason? Greetings, world, and welcome to another chat. This should be a good time.
Oh, this is going to be a blast, man. These two guys can tell stories, like literally. These guys can tell so many stories that books start jumping off of shelves with jealousy. That's how good their stories are.
Well, the good news is I have many books, none of which I've read. They just look good on camera.
Well, let's hope they don't jump out of the shelves and bash you in the back of the head because of the amount of story jealousy that's going to go on with what these two guys have got to deliver.
Back into the left.
Exactly. Just be dodging like this. So, folks, welcome to our show. If you've never been here before, this is a show that I basically started at the beginning of this whole problem that I like to refer to it as, because if we say what it's called, unfortunately, YouTube and Facebook have these algorithms that kill the show. It's a whole other story. But anyway, so the situation is that I just started this show. I'm a concert videographer and music video guy, and I live in Tokyo. I'm Australian, and I just thought, I got video skills, I got lots of friends in famous bands, and let's just spread some positivity and do some good stuff out there. So without me babbling on any further, please welcome into the show from REO Speedwagon, Mr. Dave Amato, and from Styx, Mr. Ricky Phillips. Woohoo! Welcome, gentlemen.
Jason, Paul.
Thank you.
This is going to be fun. Well, actually, to be honest, say again, Dave?
Too much pressure. You're putting the pressure on us now.
No pressure. You guys just be yourselves and we'll be all good.
Yeah, look at all the records behind you. We're the ones that are under pressure. We're career failures in comparison.
That's one way to look at it. So Dave and Ricky and myself had a chat the other day for about an hour or so on here and just shooting the proverbial shit, so to speak, and so this is definitely going to be a fun one to get into. So let's start with, firstly, Dave, you're in California, and Ricky, you're in Texas at the moment, I believe is correct, right?
Austin, Texas, yeah. Austin.
Nice. I got to get out to Texas one day. The furthest east I've ever gotten is actually Las Vegas. I've done California like many times because I go out to the NAMM show most years. Mm-hmm. And I think I've done NAMM probably five times in the last 6 years. But, I got out to Vegas last year in 2019, just before the snow hit, which was kind of bizarre. So moving on to you guys and your careers, like, let's start with how you two became friends. Because I know you guys have been friends for, like, was it 38 years now or something?
That's around there, yeah. I mean, I know it was after the babies, but we met in the very room that the baby, we used to rehearse. It was Jonathan Cain's garage, then his brother Muggsy took it over. And Muggsy called me and said, "Hey, I'm going to be working with this guy, and he's being managed by Diana Ross, and I'm bringing a guitar player that I've been working with. I think he'll be perfect for it. Let's see what we can do." So that guy went on another way, but Dave and I became friends out of this project of working with this guy for two or three rehearsals. And and man, that has to have been like, I'm going to say 82 or.
That's what I was going to say, 82. Yeah. I think, yeah. Yeah. Ricky and I just hit it off. We became really good friends. And
we like to work together too. He's fun. He plays guitar like you're supposed to. and
bass like you're looking for.
Actually, this is really cool because Dave and the other guitar player was Tim Pierce. You guys are probably familiar with Tim Pierce. He's got his own show and he does a lot of transpositions from Hendrix to whatever. But he's played on Madonna records, Bruce Springsteen.
So a bit of a nobody then.
You know what I'm saying? Like the list is like
Greg, is that Greg, Rick Springsteen? Is that the guy that plays with Dave Matthews?
No. No, okay, the only thing, he hasn't really toured in years. He did work with, he did, I had a band after the Babies with him, and then John Waite stole him from me and took him to New York to play on John's first solo record. And that, he worked with Rick Springfield. He and Rick Springfield are very close friends. And so he worked with Rick way back when Rick had his first success with Jesse's Girl. But we toured with Timmy, and then he just, the road wasn't for him. He was never... That's just not who he is. So he quit early on. He left Rick at a certain point, and has just been a session guy that has just done incredible work. But if you should look him up, you both of you, because if you haven't heard of him, really great player. And he and Dave together was other guitar players would just go, oh my gosh, you know, between the two of them, you had pretty much the whole palette. It was amazing.
I learned so much from Timmy. He was amazing. I just come to L.A. You know, in like 1980. Couple of years before I met Ricky, and basically that was the first guy I played with. What an entrance into Los Angeles to play with Tim Pierce.
Yeah, that was good. Now, fun.
Speaking of you, he's back.
Yeah,
I was gonna say, speaking of you coming into LA, now you're originally from Boston, right?
Boston, yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, Paul, where are you originally from?
I'm originally from South Boston, and actually went to college in the town that that Dave is from. And I have a story, Dave. This is a rumor / legend, and I'm gonna mention I'm gonna feed you a little bit of it, and you can either tell the story or I will tell you the rumor as I've heard it, and you can confirm or refute it. Sound good?
All right. Yeah.
You were in a band called August, correct? All right.
That's correct.
Is there a Spinal Tap connection with August?
Not that I know of.
All right. The rumor that I heard. The rumor that I heard was that during the 1982-83, and this would be probably after you had left the band, so this kind of makes sense, but I have a friend named David who has since passed, and he allegedly bought a Marshall head from you. And the story, right? Well, the story as it goes is August at one point was the band chosen to open for Spinal Tap when they did their promotional tour for the movie, because they had the most equipment in the area, and the rumor was that because August had so much equipment, Christopher Guest and Michael McKean and Harry Shearer basically found the band with the most equipment, with the caveat that they got to use that band's equipment as backline for when they came out to play. So the story is that this Marshall, I want to say it was a super lead head that my first guitar player, Dave, bought, was your Marshall super lead head that Michael McKean played through on that tour. True or false?
Really? I'm not aware of that, but that's not far-fetched, because I had a lot of Marshalls, and I do have a lot of Marshalls still.
I was gonna say, he still does.
A guy had a van and a PA. It didn't matter what instrument he played, he was in the band.
Right. Yeah. And that was
right.
But the idea that, you know, it's the typical story. You have the PA, you're in the band. It's the David Lee Roth. He got in the band because why rent the PA from him? Or they could buy it. So August, the rumor was that August, the band you were in, had opened for Spinal Tap in 82-83, but it seems like your memory is a little foggy on that.
Well, yeah. Well, I wasn't, you know, I had left in early 1980 and came to L.A. So equipment-wise, yes, I had a lot of Marshalls then, yeah. But I took them with me when I left, and I had most of them in the band. So if they got more, I don't remember if they got more, but I took most of my Marshalls with me, you know, when I left in 80, I put them in.
So my entire childhood is now a lie.
Well, the Marshall head thing could be true.
So come to the future, Dave. So how many Marshall heads do you own?
Heads?
Oh, just heads.
A dangerous question.
50, just heads. 50. How many basket weave stacks do you have?
How many stacks?
How many basket weave stacks do you have? Metal handles.
Oh, 16. not 16, eight stacks, 16 cabinets. Wow. And double heads. It's 16 or 17 heads too.
Wow. Okay.
60s.
All right. I'm telling you, it's insane. Like Dave's collection, if you guys haven't already seen it, over on the Gibson YouTube channel, it's Gibson TV. That's like a grab from that. It's called The Collection, : Dave Amato. Now, he's got just, and this is just the tip of the iceberg here, right, in this shot, Dave.
Oh, yeah.
It is ludicrous. Like,
there's the Marshalls over there, but there's tons more on the other side.
It's a shame they're not in very good shape.
Oh, my God. Like, I mean, this is a guy who's got a collection. If any of you watching this are guitar collectors and you haven't seen this video, I urge you to go watch it. Like, that's an original 1983 Flying V Carina, which, if you don't know what a Carina is, basically it's a very expensive wood. And he owns all three of the guitars in the collection from that year. And this Gibson Explorer here is mint, right, Dave? You've never played this thing.
No, no. It was so cherry, I just kind of tucked it in the up there. And just
it blows
just
my mind.
Which brings us back to Spinal Tap. Don't even look at it. Don't even touch it. It can't be played.
Pretty much, yeah. Yeah. Hey, and I bought a lot of that stuff from Norm's, which was in the movie, right? Norm's Rare Guitars. He left the guitar for the movie. Norm's
got a modern. I mean, who the hell? Nobody owns a modern in Carina except you. It's just ridiculous.
That one looks like it's been played. Has that been played a bit? Just by looking at the pickups, they look like it's got a little wear on it, or is that all? Is that just a photo?
You know what? My thing is frozen again. Are you looking at the guitar?
I thought you were becoming a ventriloquist. That was really good.
My screen is frozen. Look, that's the way it goes.
You want to reboot?
That's all right. It'll come back.
Good. I have to. I want to tell him about you while you're gone. So there he is.
Yeah, there you go. Now let's ditch.
Right.
I got it. So
where's the dirt, Ricky?
Well,
yeah, that's all right. It's pretty hard to have dirt on Dave.
It's good.
He's such a nice fellow.
He's got clean dirt. Of course it is.
Clean dirt. I like that. He's got washed dirt.
Now,
for those of you who are watching out there, if you're seeing this and you want to get some comments on the side, like you can see here, we've got some hollows coming in from Cape Coral. And I actually saw earlier, and unfortunately the chat's running a little bit fast for me right at the moment. There was a gentleman. Here we go. I found it. Hello from Manchester, UK. Now, if I'm not mistaken, it is roughly 1:13 in the morning in Manchester in the UK. Nice. Ricky, you've got fans watching all the way over there, mate.
That's awesome.
We got fans watching in Oklahoma, in Arizona. Maybe Paul's next door neighbor. Maybe even in the window at Paul's house right now.
It's very possible.
From New York, we've got from country Alabama. We've got people here. We got another one from New York. Another one from Arizona, Florida. Johnny Bean, who's one of the friends that actually hooked me and Paul up originally, who runs a show of his own, Johnny Bean TV. Check it out, folks. He does some fun stuff like this too. And he's saying hello to Amanda Coombs, who, there we go, she's there. She's up in Canada. Reno, we've got watching. We got over here in MI saying hello to REO and Styx. There's a lot of people watching at the moment. We've even got a person down in Chile watching. Hola, ¿cómo te va? So, yeah, man, there's a lot of people watching it. It's great. So if you want to be in the chats and your chats aren't coming up into our mainstream, you'd need to either be commenting on YouTube, which is where we're playing right now. If you look up the acronym for the show, so instead of live streams with Famous Friends, just LSWFF, look that up on YouTube and you'll be able to see it there and you can comment on there. You can also comment if you go to the original page that I run, which is called Live Streams with Famous Friends by Jason McNamara. And Dave is back.
So we're trying to set up another computer here. I have another computer, so we're going to try to start that up. I'm sorry, guys.
That's a crank on the front of it. How old is it?
Here's a great comment here. This is nice. A nice little. How are you doing about how well? Bad English reference, and like putting up there with REO and Journey and all that stuff like that. You guys cross paths with so many different people between the Babies and REO and Styx and all that stuff. How weird is it to be connected like the 6 degrees of separation with so many different artists?
How is it?
How weird is it? Like, you guys see each other like every couple of years and just pick up your conversations. Like, you guys said you've been friends for 38 years. How often do you actually stay in touch?
G'day, Katoomba, just quickly. Sorry, go on, guys.
Well, we played a lot with the Styx and REO on tour. So, you know, when we're on tour, we're like usually, you know, all summer or a lot, you know. So Ricky and I hang out with each other.
Some of the background, too, I mean, people maybe should know is like Dave and I, it just isn't music. We, you know, we've hung out. We played baseball together a lot for like 20 years. We played baseball together. We had the same circle of friends. And we had kind of we started this baseball game. It's interesting because L.A. can be very, very spread out and everybody's there for, it seems like everybody's got an agenda and this and that. But we had this group of friends that we really enjoy. We had barbecues and we'd hang. And so after a barbecue at my house, as a matter of fact, one time we started to go and play softball. So all these guys start getting in their cars and trudging off with cases of beer. And we played baseball. Well, that kind of planted the seed, and we realized we were kind of starting to develop a communal thing in a large city. And it carried on for actually over 20 years.
Yeah.
With a lot of the same people. And then I don't even know if it's any of the same people are there now, but apparently it still has carried on. I mean, eventually we had people like Eddie Van Halen, Steve Lukather, a lot of guys from Toto would show up. All the local guys, they'd show up, and Muggsy Kane and I would usually be we kind of started it this way. We'd flip a coin to see who got the first choice, and we would pick from who was there. And it just became, it was a real brotherhood of people that have, people still contact me about it. And people were flying in from Boston, from New York, from all over the East Coast because they heard, okay, listen, if you get to LA, if you want a gig, all the guys are hanging every Sunday morning over at Beeman Park in Studio City. And if you get there, you got to work your way into the game because you're caught on by then. But if you want a connection, you want to get an audition with somebody, that's where you go. So we had all these guys showing up, and I'm going, who are these guys? You know, but
and who's taking a line drive off the fist and going, oh no!
Oh yeah. Oh, yeah.
We've busted a couple of fingers and got scraped. Yeah. I tore my ACL one time. Remember, Ricky, going down the first? Just blew my ACL right out. I mean, we were like weekend warriors, man.
Michael Morgan came to play with us one Sunday, yeah. And the poor guy, my shortstop took him out of second base, and I think cracked one of his ribs. I mean, it's just like, it was serious ball.
Yeah.
We didn't do it on purpose, but I'm just saying, it wasn't like, oh, you know, baby catcher or anything. We were playing serious. I still have scars on my legs from sliding into, you know, third and home and everything. It was a blast. It was fun. And we all got little injuries here and there. I remember Joey Madari, we had to hold a little special. What did we do to raise money for him? I can't remember, but we all raised money for him so he could pay his rent for 3 months because his shoulder was totally gone. Great bass player. And he couldn't work. He had a wife and kid. And so we figured out a way to get money to at least pay his rent and keep him afloat. But yeah, it was serious ball. We had fun. But I really brought it up because I just was wanting to realize Dave and I are dear, dear friends. His father played golf with his father years and years ago before he passed, and he was one of my favorite people on the planet. Mm-hmm. He knows my folks. My folks have come to see us play, or just, you know, when they come to visit, Dave would come visit. But, you know, this is a true friendship. It's not just like see you on the road whenever our bands play.
I mean, if I don't see Ricky for, you know, 2 or 3 months, which we hate, but everybody gets busy. I mean, we can come right back to it. You know what I mean? Right back when we left off. It's a real good friendship. It's always been that way. Always.
That is super cool. It really is. I want to address the fact of, like, you guys having such a dear friendship and then helping each other to get into the certain musical things, as you were just saying, and softball was a big part of the connection. Me being Australian, all right, and I've just received a message from a gentleman named Craig Wright, who's just asked, will you bring REO or Styx and or Styx or together or whatever to Australia, which will also lead us down Dave's history road with Australia. So if I'm not mistaken, Styx and or REO have not played in, since you guys have been in the bands, in Australia, right, or in Japan.
Yeah, correct.
No.
Shame, gentlemen. Yeah. Shame. No, it's the way it goes. I
mean, yeah. Well, we want to go. There's, you know, not, you know, we really want to go, but it's just a matter of money, I guess, or find, I don't know. Just, I'm not
is
sure.
It difficult? Is it difficult for you guys when you set up your tours? Like, obviously, tour routing in the United States is much easier in the spring, summer, early fall, and then, you know, obviously, that's the other side of the world is in a different seasonal issue. Is it difficult to set up your tour routing so that you can finish the United States and then go across the seas?
I don't think it works that way, really. It's, you know, I don't know how you guys do it exactly, Dave, but I'm sure it's similar to us. I mean, it's a losing proposition money-wise to go to Europe, but we love to go. So we make ourselves go at a certain point. It costs so much to tour that it really doesn't pay for itself, only in the exposure that you get. So we have to be very careful. We have an A rig. How many rigs do you guys? We have an A rig and a B rig.
We have two.
Okay. Yeah,
same thing. We
pretty much have the same rig on. So in other words, if we're finishing in New York, but we've got to be in London in, you know, 3 or 4 weeks, 3 weeks ahead of time, they send the B rig, put it on the boat and send it over.
Is it because there are so few outlets there? Is that why, like, financially it doesn't make sense for the cost?
I really don't think it's that. I think it's how much it costs to physically get over there, get the gear there. We refuse. If we're going to do a Styx show, and REO is the same way, you're going to see an REO show. You're going to see their gear. It's not going to be a backline from a local music store. We want our staging as much as we can. It's broken down, of course, but as much as we can, and we want people to really get, they're paying their good money, they might as well get the right show. We want to do it too. So,
that's the same reason why I know band like Rush never ever played in Australia, because they wanted to take their full show. But Dave, you do have a history with playing in Australia. So, like, just for those of you who are watching, if you're in Australia, or even if you're not from Australia, there's a singer in Australia by the name of Jimmy Barnes, who is an absolute massive legend in Australia. I mean, Jimmy Barnes in Australia, in our culture, is very much like Bruce Springsteen is to America. You know, right. He's a rocker and a half. And he enlisted you to play in his band. So yeah. The funny thing is, like, the whole connection between you guys, like you were saying about, like, how Ricky, you were playing with Jonathan Cain in the Babies before Bad English. But around that sort of time of forming Bad English, Jonathan was also writing music with Jimmy Barnes. Now, actually, just quickly, for those of you out there who may know the song, I'll just get my piano on here. This is the song Working Class Man by Jimmy Barnes, which most of you, even if you don't realize you know it, would probably know this song.
Oh, look at this. Someone's auditioning.
Haven't played it for a while, but anyway, you get the idea. If you've heard that song before,
you got the gig. You got it.
Yeah, no, I didn't. I messed up.
Yeah, I was going to say, someone is completely auditioning.
Very far from it. I've just got the gear here, and it's easier than bringing it up on YouTube sometimes. But I've already got another. Let's call Jimmy. Yeah, I wish we could call Jimmy, but I've got another clip lined up here of you on stage, and that's why I've got this set to go. So here is Dave on stage with Jimmy Barnes in 1988, right?
Check out the
clothing and check out the guitar that he's playing.
Boy.
This is so 1988. Here we go. Let's have a quick look at this.
Oh God!
Nice.
Now, is that Dave Amato or Richie Sambora?
Yeah.
He's modeling from the Sambora collection.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. There's Jimmy right there. There's Diesel in the background.
That's right. I was trying to bring, you know, look at that hair. Nice.
Still looks like you, though.
And he's making guitar faces, which is important. You got that part down.
Keyboard fingers going off.
That's it. Wow.
How's it feel to see this after all these years, Dave?
Wow.
The funny thing about watching this is, like, I'm sorry to say, your clothing is so dated, but when you see Mark, as in Diesel, Mark Lazotte, he's right there. Look at him. He still looks timeless in the leather jacket. And
it looks great.
Looks like he should have been in Stray Cats.
He's a true Australian legend now, that guy.
Well,
so So anyway,
you know what? I was the only American, you know, and I was trying to bring the '80s because Down Under was Down Under then in the '80s. So yeah. I was trying to bring what we were doing in America over there, you know, with the clothing. You know, it was the '80s. So it was, you know, the hair bands and wilder clothes or whatever, you know.
You were the only American, but not necessarily, because I believe Mark was born in Massachusetts as well, like down in New Bedford or Fall River, something like that.
You know what? You're right. You're absolutely right. Yeah, he was. But, you know, he was an Australian through and through, really.
Right, sure. Yeah, no, I mean, you know, you can't help where you're born. You're where you're from is where you're from. But
when
I mean,
was the last time you spoke to him, Dave?
Jimmy?
No, Mark.
Oh, God. Oh, probably back then.
Really? No, you haven't spoken to him for that long?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well Mark, sorry, Dave.
Yeah.
Say hello to Mark.
Hey.
Come on.
How are you, buddy?
He's frozen.
Yes, he's frozen.
Snap out of it, Dave.
He's in that much shock.
Get the taser out.
He's on the line, really?
Yeah, he's right there.
I can't see. I'm frozen again.
Mark and I caught up yesterday and had a chat. I was like, dude, can you come on and say hello? And he's like, hell yeah.
Oh,
and now, of course,
God, really?
We're having technical issues. He's right there.
Well, it's funny. It's all going around in circles because
okay. Mark!
Dave!
Are you there?
Yeah.
Oh, Dave is so pissed right now.
Except you. I'm frozen.
He'll be back in one second.
Mark,
he'll be
nice doing this.
He's gone to change his underwear.
Thanks for making your time to come onto the show, mate.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
All the Aussies watching will be like, oh, my God, there's Diesel. They'll be freaking out right now.
I love the fact that...
Have you and Ricky crossed paths before?
I'm sorry?
Have you and Ricky ever crossed paths before?
I don't believe so, no.
No, we haven't.
Nice to meet you guys.
Nice to meet you. I know a lot of the guys you worked with.
Yeah, I'm sure. It's only the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon in the music industry.
Right,
so.
Right.
Exactly. Hey, there you go, Dave. It's really here.
Can't hear it. He's trying. This is the beauty of the internet in 2020. This is happening a lot all over the world right now. This happens all of these.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah.
Can't hear it.
We can hear you perfectly. Oh, put your headphones back in, Dave. Headphones.
I hear you.
Oh.
Yeah, I told you one quad box was enough back then. We had to have two quad boxes, and now you can't hear anything.
Is that the truth? Yes.
Give me your earphones.
Headphones, Dave. Headphones.
You don't have earphones.
It's in the other room.
Yeah. The headphones will help.
Do you want me to do the other one again?
Yeah, turn on the other one.
This is going so smoothly.
Yes, professional broadcast experience.
I love how Danielle's trying to sneak around the house but doesn't realize we can actually see her right now.
And it's a good thing she is sneaking around the house helping.
Yes.
I know, it's funny. Even at home, you have to have somebody like assist you, like a roadie or a tour manager or somebody
like
that.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah, just show up in time.
It's the Wi-Fi. I don't know where the sound is on that one.
I don't even know where to plug this in.
I'll just mute his mic for now while they get
the sound. Yeah, we could witness a domestic here at some point.
Nah. She's a great support to him.
Sure.
Hey, I just came in on the end of what you guys were talking about are you coming down, Ricky, or are we planning to come down to Australia?
You know, we've wanted to, and there have been a couple occasions where we thought, finally, and something would happen, and we didn't go. But yeah, I would love to go. I filled in for a buddy of mine in 2003 who was a keyboard player and played all the secondary guitars, sang all the high harmonies with Creedence, and I got to go to New Zealand. That's as close as I got.
I remember, was it the John Fogerty came out and did like a show with Kenny Aronoff, and he played a lot of Creedence stuff. Was that the tour? Yeah, because that came through Australia. And
It wasn't with Fogerty. It was the Creedence band.
The rest of Creedence. Okay, got it.
They had an ugly show. So they carried on.
Close it.
Fair enough.
How do I close it? It was close it. Playing keyboards and
yeah. Well, I mean, I'd be happy touring New Zealand, just if it was only just New Zealand. That's worth it just to be see New Zealand, but it'd be crazy not to like go another 2 hours and make it to the big island.
Yeah, I know. And I don't know what that was about, but we were there during in Auckland during what's called the World Cup, the race.
Boat. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And they were all, the very first gig was there, and all around the bay where we were all these yachts. And so after the songs, it was insane. And then I got invited to taste some wine on this Spanish count on his private yacht, and we sang Beatles songs till 3 a.m.
That sounds awful.
As you do.
Terrible. Yeah.
Is there a place on the planet neither of you any of you guys haven't played that you want to play?
I mean,
anywhere outside of your house right now, obviously.
Sorry. One second, yeah. Dave. Have we got you back on yet?
Yeah. Yay. I've got the other computer. I've got two computers here, and they both, I'm not working. That's right. Insane.
Well, look, we've only got Mark here for about another 10 minutes because he's got another thing to get to. So let's let these two have a quick catch-up chat.
Hardwire that computer if you can.
Yeah.
I have the picture, but no sound. I don't know what's going on.
Let's not worry about it. We got you now.
Mark. Yeah, Mark, I can hear you. I can hear you, but can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you.
Great. Fantastic. How are you?
How you doing?
It's been a long time.
How you doing?
The last time I saw you, I was saying to Jason, you took us up to that sushi place that's up in the hills that overlooks over the lights of LA. You took us up there.
Oh, the magic.
Yes.
Yeah. You took us up for some special sushi for Jep and I.
That's right.
Yeah.
Wow.
That was, I think, and that was after the whole touring thing. And I think I was just in Los Angeles recording. And we caught up. And that's been that long. And then the other night we watched binge watching Ozark, and I saw that REO Speedwagon came into the script. And I thought, I wonder if we're actually going to see a band, or is it just like been scripted in, and then a band's going to be off in the distance, and we're led to believe that that's supposed to be them, but they didn't actually get the band. And then I said to Jep, what if Dave Amato just pops up on the screen? And then he did. It just like, if I wasn't sitting in the couch, I would have fallen over.
Oh, man.
It was so good to see you. It was like,
great to talk to you, man. Great to talk to you.
I know you haven't stopped since, and neither have I. So I know it's like, just, you know, it's just one tour after another, pretty much, isn't it? Metaphorically and literally.
Always. Yeah, always.
Ain't that the truth?
I mean, 31 years in REO Speedwagon for me is my 31st year.
That's incredible. Well, I've had a band now. After I moved back from New York, next year will be 20 years. I've had the same two people in my little three piece. It's a power trio, you know. And that's just like ridiculous. I'm like, I'm almost feel like the, you know, Rolling Stones, like 20 years. It's pretty amazing to have the same players for 20 years. You know, you get that language where just notes become like your own little secret language. It's pretty cool.
Do you see Jimmy still?
Oh yeah, all the time. Yeah. We actually, he still likes living up in the Highlands. They've got a whole nother thing there. They live on a river now, not far from where they used to live, but in that same area.
He'll be back in a sec. He's having so many issues with his internet, but he'll be back in a sec.
We should address the fact that in Ozark, and there may be some truth to this, that REO Speedwagon are a drug front.
Yeah, I know. I was saying to Jason, the guy
money laundering,
the man that plays the manager in that ep, I'm interested to know, is that really their manager or is that someone, an actor? Because I thought he acted like a quintessential tour manager, the way he sort of spoke and was like, I'm just kidding you, you know.
Yeah, it's probably easier to teach a tour tour manager how to act than it is to teach an actor how to tour manage.
I said to Jason, I said they're all like savants, you know, anyway. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They have a special gene.
While we've got a quick second here and Dave's trying to get himself back on, quick announcement for all of you out there watching the show. Mark, aka Diesel, is actually going to be appearing on the show. We're going to do one of our Oz Rock Friday night specials. It's going to be May the 15th, so not next Friday, as in next week's Friday, but the one after. And we're going to do a sit down and a bit of a career retrospective with Diesel on his career and go through some songs and chat musically and listen to some tunes. And yeah, it's going to be a bit of fun. So if you're a Diesel fan, check it out. It's going to be a cool one.
All right, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yay.
So, Mark, before he disappears again, ask him the question you just had.
No, I'm on a different computer now. So,
Cool.
Much better. Much better. Well, we were just wondering, I was talking about you popping up on Ozark, the man that plays the role of the tour manager slash manager, I'm not sure, but is that an actual man, the actual manager? Because he acted very, very real.
It's an actor. That was an actor. Okay. Yeah.
I just thought his whole demeanor and just the way his timing, the way he delivered the lines, the way he dressed was very, they must have done some research. That's all I can say.
Yeah. Would your tour manager have asked for a bigger percentage if he was going to be on the TV show?
Yeah. Under some more money.
Yes. It's
highly possible.
It was pretty spot on. Pretty spot on.
Well, Marcus, great to see you, man.
You too. And I'm guessing you're still living in the Los Angeles area?
Yep.
We have, you know, our youngest is living there now, so that gives us an excuse to go there a lot. So we'll have to catch up next time.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah,
send you guys each other's numbers after the show. That's fine.
Absolutely. Can you do that for me, Jason? Yeah.
Of course. Well,
Mark, I want to talk to Jimmy, too.
Absolutely.
I've been talking to Jimmy
in years. You'll have to catch up because he's written like two books. He's had like a documentary. It's like there's so much stuff that's happened for him. It's insane.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
Yeah.
You kill me, Jason. Yeah. That's really cool.
Mate, I you know what? When we were chatting, Dave and I have been chatting a lot over the last week or so, and I just kind of thought to myself, you know what? I need to try and do something special. It was funny because I actually reached out to another friend who put me in contact with Warwick, who's Mark's sound guy and assistant. And Warwick got back to me. He's like, "You're not going to believe this. Mark and I were just talking 10 minutes ago on the phone about Dave because I've got to stop doing that. Because Mark saw him on Ozark 10 minutes beforehand. Yeah. So how's that for Kismet?
Yeah. So just kind of like looped around. But yeah, just quickly talking about that footage that we saw before of the barnstorming. I think that was filmed at the Royal Easter Show. I'm not sure if you remember. It was a beautiful night. I remember the weather was just incredible. There was the Ferris wheel off in the distance, you know.
Yeah.
I just remember it was like we'd done a few shows by then, and it was usually when they say, "Oh, we're going to record this one," it usually always goes to shit. You know what I mean? As soon as someone says we're recording, it's just like, you know. But that was like a magic night where everything just kind of, it was just a good night.
There was no fix-its or anything.
No. And no. I didn't listen to it until years and years later. But that's very typical me. I don't really like you do something and you just kind of go, "Yeah, that was all right." And then, but it came on into my thing, and I listened to the audio and was like, "It's like, you know, our sounds are so different." But it's both, you know, it's two guitar thing, but because our sounds were so different, they just work so well, you know. Yeah.
And you're not gonna lie, you look a little like Doc Neeson in that video.
Well, for those of you who don't get the reference, that's an Australian band called The Angels. Paul's a bit of an Australian music aficionado.
Yeah, I can tell.
The Angels, yeah. Well, hey, for example, Ricky, I'll bring Ricky into this. Tony Brock is playing drums right there. So Tony and Ricky were the Babies. So here's another connection with Ricky and I. Tony was in the Babies.
That's right.
With Ricky.
He was a token Englishman in the band at the time. Every band has to have an English drummer, right?
He loved working.
Look at this guy.
With you guys too. I know. He talked about it all the time. He loved that band. He really loved his time with Jimmy.
He was just the monster sound, like the biggest, the loudest drummer I've ever played with at the time. It was just insane. Right. He had like a drum fill that was basically a PA for most bands would be enough for a PA, and he had him behind him.
There he is.
There it is. You can see that PA. And, you know,
yeah.
He had the, he's just got those snare fills that are just like the right fills for rock, for Jimmy's music anyway. It's just always the right fill.
Absolutely.
That was a good band, man. That was a really good band.
Yeah, and seeing Peter Cacal always, you know, makes me well up because I don't know if you know, but we lost him a few years ago. And
I didn't know.
Yeah, really? Yeah, he took his life. It's another one of those terrible stories, you know, that people in the music industry I think these days there's a lot more things that people can reach out to. Well, Support Act here in Australia, for instance, I'm sure there are this is same equivalent in America, but there's, you know, depression and anxiety and just, you know, going into a dark place for a lot is very common with creatives, in either actors or music people or artists of any type. So unfortunately he slipped through that crack, but I feel like if he was around today that he might have been able to talk to somebody. So maybe you want to put those numbers up on the screen at some point, Jason, and if not this show, but some show coming up, because we're in a pretty bit of a dark time at the moment. And yeah, especially for people like us who, you know, normally we get to go out, you know, for me, it's 120 times a year I get to go out and just sort of cleanse my soul by playing in front of people. And it's hard at the moment. You know, I feel kind of like, on a good note, I don't know about you, but I feel recently I had this feeling and I'm kind of trying to identify it. And I just thought, I know this feeling. This is the feeling I had when I was 13. I just bought my first overdrive pedal, the Boss overdrive, the yellow one. You know, I went down to the local shop. There was a choice of two pedals, the orange one or the yellow one. One said distortion, one said overdrive. I was like, overdrive sounds cooler. I like the sound of overdrive. I'll have that one. And I had my cheap Korean Les Paul copy, Junior Les Paul. And my brother, who'd moved to Europe to work with the circus, left literally, went off and worked with Holiday on Ice, and left me a Vox AC50, which I didn't know what it was, big 50-watt head and a 212 cabinet in my bedroom. So I had all this gear. I just flipped from playing cello to guitar. And then suddenly I feel like I'm ready. I want to do gigs. And that feeling of like, I want to get out and do a show. And if I was only 13, but I was ready to go out and play. Of course I wasn't ready, but that's the feeling I have now. You know, I'm just like, I can't wait to just do a show again. It's kind of good, I suppose. You know,
well, you bring up a good point. Diesel, you bring up a good point. Things like this obviously are very therapeutic for a lot of different people. So just an opportunity before you guys have a chance to tap out or anything. Thank you for doing this, because not only it just shows that nobody is alone. They're sitting here. A lot of people have come to the internet and are starting to watch things like this. And guys like you and Dave and Ricky are feeling all of the same things that everybody else is. And even more so, because your entire life is predicated upon social interaction every night for an hour and a half on stage. And if you don't get that, your routine has been so interrupted. So thank you for taking time and being honest about that.
Yeah. Well, you know, it is what it is, but there has to be some positives. And I suppose that's all I'm trying to say is the positive is it's like that, just work on that fire and just, like tap into that fire of like that feeling of like, God, I can't wait to play. And instead of going doom and gloom, like we're not playing, just like think of that when you are going to play, you know, and you're just going to get out there. And I hope I'm not like I was when I was 15 and just stared at my shoes for like the whole gig, you know.
Ricky and I were supposed to be, we're going to probably do a big tour next year with Styx and REO, but we had a couple of shows coming up, you know, just like four shows, Ricky, right? I think.
Yeah.
I think we just missed one, and you know, we talked about, hey, I'm gonna see you, you know, in a couple of weeks or a month or something like that, and it just, you know, I have to see him on, you know, on a TV here or whatever, on a computer instead, you know. I want to see him
at work.
Well, but it's great. It's connecting, you know. I feel I've connected with you today, and that's a feeling, you know, like whether it's electronic or not, it's still a feeling.
Oh, Mark, that's great to see you. This is you really. Too. I couldn't believe it. You're kidding me, right?
Wow. Mate, it's an absolute pleasure. And you know what? I'm glad I could do this for you. And I'm going to go real cheeseball here for your beautiful moment here together, guys.
Oh.
Continue telling about how much you love each other, because you can't fight this feeling anymore.
This just happened. Ladies' choice, all skate. Ladies, all skate.
I mean, the whole time you were saying that, Mark, I couldn't help it. See, for those of you Americans out there, you got to understand, us Australians, we just have this crazy, stupid sense of humor. It's just the way that we're wired.
I understand. True.
Now, this brings me, that this, like, just instantly when I hear that song, I'm back, I'm like 13 years old again, and at the roller skating rink.
Oh, hell yeah.
For the slow skate, that was at the end of the night before they tell everyone to get out. Yeah.
And Ricky, you having a good time watching this love fest?
Absolutely.
Now, for those of you out there who aren't familiar with his music, I just want you to know that, like, Mark, aka Diesel, is a big deal in Australia. He's a true legend of Aussie rock. So here's a little bit of a taste of him live with the band. This is 2004. Great song, Man Alive. Joy Bonamassa on drums. Now, here's a cool fact. Just back there in the background, just behind him there, if I'm not mistaken, that's your father in the blue shirt on saxophone, right?
Yeah, that is my dad. Sadly, not with us anymore. But yeah, he rocked it to the wheels fell off. And yeah, and that was, like, you know.
Was he a professional musician?
So, you know, he never really just did that only. But after he came out of the Navy, he did a little, you know, electronics thing, because he learned his trade of electronics in the Navy. And I grew up with, like, a house full of, like, vacuum tubes, and yeah, it was pretty handy. He built me one of my first guitar amps, and then the saxophone was just always something that he had around and would go out and do gigs on the weekend. So yeah,
he's got too many devices around him.
I got too much stuff going on today. Oh my God,
he's a mover and shaker.
He loved jazz, and I think, yeah, probably one of my biggest influences was his record collection, really, and his sax playing, for sure. So it's good to get him up and jam the gigs that we could.
How often did you get a chance to do that?
Quite often. I mean, especially my mum passed away of a rare lung disease, like 12 years before he passed, and he could have, like, easily gone down that hole, like a lot of people when they get to that age, where one goes and the other one just kind of perishes. But he chose to, like, you know, we made a blues record that in that period together, and he came on a lot of little runs with us, and I'd go down because he's living in Tasmania, so I'd be there at least once or twice a year. So yeah, we played in that period, we played a lot, and it was really good, because that was, you know, what he lived for. In fact, even up right at, he had a stroke, and even like that was what ultimately took him down. But that during that week he went to 3 gigs in a wheelchair. He just was not going to stop.
Wow.
You know, he was just like, okay, I can see what's ahead of me, but I want to put my foot on the accelerator. And my brother was like, okay, if you want to go to this gig, I'll take you. He did it. Yeah, he was literally at 3 shows the week he passed away. It's just like crazy.
That's a fighter.
Yeah,
good for him.
Well, tough old Navy guy, you know.
Before you end up telling me off about making you stay on the show too long, you said you've got an appointment for something.
I do. Technically in 10 minutes. So, but I'm still in. I'm still in the sort of safe zone if I sign off now. So I'll do that, guys.
Yeah, because I don't want to get in. I don't want to be in trouble for you being late for your other appointment.
Yeah, it's like the internet is got me by the short and curlies these days.
Yeah, but you know what? I mean, I can tell from the tone of your voice, man, that this is important to you. Like, I can feel your sort of your stress and your anxiety. You need this.
Just like, dude.
That's all right. We'll be doing a big 2-hour show on this, like,
I hope so.
On the 15th. So keep in mind. So for the American side of things, it's going to be hard, because it's going to be like 3 o'clock in the morning to 6 o'clock in the morning across the Americas. But for the UK and Europe and Australia, it's going to be primo. I'll get the promos up on that. So keep an eye on the website, folks. Live streams. So it's the acronym up in the top corner above Ricky's corner up there, lswff.com. Thank you, Ricky. Look at him. What a champion. Yeah. So I'm not trying to push him out, but I'm trying to push him out because I know he's got things to do and I don't want to be responsible once again. So,
Diesel, can we what numbers with Jason? Let's do it. And I want to talk
Absolutely. He's got my number, so yeah, we can do that. Okay. Absolutely.
Great. I will text everybody. You guys after the show.
And if anyone's ever down this way, yeah, you know, this guy can hook us up. And I live near the airport. I've got a big warehouse for the studio, and come by and see me.
Love
to. There you go. Ricky, you got a connection now in Australia too, mate.
I like it. Like, I'm there.
Yeah. Thanks, Mark. Come and have a cup of tea. See you guys.
All right. Thanks, Mark. I really appreciate you dropping by, mate.
Thanks for having me. Cheers, guys. Take care.
Cheers.
All right. So there you go.
Wow.
That was cool.
I thought you'd appreciate that, mate.
I did. Well, I was shocked. I just couldn't believe it. I was like, what? Get out of here.
I did want to get Jimmy as well, but unfortunately Jimmy's just got a little bit too much on his plate at the moment. So, but we did try. So, Ricky, thank you so much for being patient while we went through all that, mate. That was very, very kind of you to let that happen.
Oh, Lord, it's great to meet him. I mean, seriously, I've heard about it for how many years now, David?
Oh,
been a long time.
Long time, yeah. Yeah. Well, I left him in 88. He did come to L.A., you know, couple of years after, you know, but this is a long time ago since I've seen him, you know. So
what's that? Somebody's got
somebody's got a ring.
Oh, it's my girl's phone. I got phones in here. I got two computers.
You're like an entertainment czar today.
We had a very funny comment here from Tag Miller before. It was Kevin calling you.
Kevin Cronin?
Yeah, I gather that was the joke because, you know.
It was the joke because the phone kept ringing.
Okay, gotcha.
Exactly.
I've literally been walking 10 feet behind David, and I've called him. And he's got earpiece in this ear, earpiece in that. His phones are just almost falling out of his hands.
You know, my girl was trying to help me with two computers, so I got her phone and my phone because I was trying to call you and say, I can't get this thing.
Well, so much for the rumor that when you guys aren't on the road, you don't do anything. Like, right, there's always that perception as well when these bands aren't touring, they just sit around and do nothing. And that couldn't be further from the truth based upon the experience today.
Yes.
Well, we're touring together. That's a lot of fun because I love to play golf. There's guys in his, you know, Bruce, his bass player, he and I both play, go out and find a course. When we were out, let's see. He hit a hole in one. I can't try to remember where that was. It was a crazy thing. We find all kinds of things. And then our tour managers will find a night where we have two nights off in a city, and both bands will take over a nice restaurant someplace in whatever town we're in. Those nights they should be filmed. It's a lot of fun.
Styx and REO.
Well, we did just get a comment about that. Go on.
Styx and REO, it's one big family. I mean, no lie. It's really all the guys, we love each other. And you know, there's no, I don't want to hang with him. We hang with each and every one of them. It's really a love fest, Styx and REO. It's great.
And really, I'm glad you brought up about those two bands because I really wanted to ask about this. This is kind of like, with the conversation we're going to have today, this is the main question that I wanted to get into during this. And we can have a laugh and do the other things, and hopefully we'll have a laugh with the question. But the thing I wanted to get into here was you guys are both members of legacy bands, so to speak. So, you know, those bands like the Rolling Stones who've been around forever and there's just, you know, those certain bands that have continued. Aerosmith is another example. And, of course, REO Speedwagon and Styx are two of those bands that started out in the late 60s, early 70s, and are still going today. But you guys are not original members of the band, being that Dave's been in the band in area now for 31 years, and Ricky, if I'm not mistaken, you've been in Styx now for 17 years, I believe.
In a few months, it'll be 17 years, and I've got a story about that. You finish where you're going. I got something to add to that.
Oh, very cool. Thank you. So where I'm getting at with this is, how did you guys both get into your respective bands? And also, how is it as far as, like, when you very first joined, was it like, if you've seen the movie Rockstar with Mark Wahlberg, where, you know, the new guy comes in being Mark Wahlberg's character and he's getting booed by fans. Hopefully you guys never suffered that, but like, you know, I'm just curious to know the story that we don't normally get to hear, which is why we're doing this show, to tell stories we don't normally get to hear. Dave, how is it coming into a legacy band?
I don't know if I've ever told you this, Dave. When it was first released to the press that I was the new guy, I got, you know, pretty good. People knew who I was before. They knew what I'd done, that I'd been in the Babies Band, English, and countless other things maybe I've produced or written songs for. But I had this one guy, he said, "You better not suck." It was basically, there was more to it, but that was the way, that was his tagline. That's how he finished off. And so I thought, okay, this is going to be weird. And I know that you're coming in from a guy that wrote great songs, songs that you and I both love.
Yeah.
And what you have to do, and you give me your side of this, but you just, with me, it's a little bit different because Chuck is still in the band. It's just that Chuck has had, it's been no secret that Chuck has had medical issues and all kinds of stuff, and he just can't do the gig full on from beginning to end. But he's been very supportive, and he, you know, pays me compliments every night. And that helps. When your band loves you, that other stuff, it's gone away now, but, you know, 15 years ago, it was still happening. The first couple of years I was in the band, there would be, you know, "You're not the original guy," kind of stuff. I'll just leave it at that. But I have to say the Styx fans are, and I know the REO fans are as well, but I'll let you speak for them. Styx fans are incredible. I mean, they're a family amongst themselves. There's people who take vacations together who are Styx fans. I mean, they become Styx fans by being and meeting at the concerts, and it's this huge bed of incredible people. So those people have always kind of been there from the very beginning for me to kind of help. At first I was kind of like, "Hey, what's going on? You know, I don't want to, let's keep a distance," but I realized that it was genuine, and I've seen them for all these years. They're still there on the front row and at the meet and greets and all that stuff, and they're just great people. But
I think it's also notable that Styx, you know, because Chuck has had some of the health problems, the fact that there is that camaraderie and there is that partnership and mutual respect and understanding, yeah. Styx should be commended for that, because, you know, very few bands will stand by a member that can't fulfill their duties full time. Sure. I think that's an amazing testament to what a great band and great organization you're involved in.
I agree. I totally agree. Yeah. I mean, it's, the words have never been spoken. It's just been understood. He is deep in the brotherhood. He and his twin brother started the band. And no matter if he has to crawl on the stage, he's welcome on that stage and always will be. Not welcome, but he should be there. I mean, that's just the way everybody feels.
It's a family. And, you know, I know the Styx family is pretty really strong, and REO is as well. You know, it's really and that's why we mesh so good, because it's, we all get along good, and it's, you know what, it's all really good people in both bands. You know what I mean? The guys in Styx, they're just good people. You know, and same with, you know, our band REO. It's just really good guys. Really, you know, heartfelt, good down home guys.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
The chemistry you guys have is of a different sort than the chemistry we have. But what is identical and the same is that the thing moves like a machine, or it's got a soul and it's got a living energy to it that is you guys. And we have the same thing in a different arena.
Yeah.
And it's still rock, but it's a totally different flavor. And it seemed, for whatever, you and I have laughed about this. We don't even know why the fans love to see us together. But whenever we're booked together, it's sold out every night. And
it's true. Yeah. And it always works for some reason. It always works. And people come out to see us, I guess, because they feel that, you know, we get along. Everybody's smiling usually. Here's the thing. Both bands, we have the same feeling about this. We want to do give the fans 1,000% every night, both bands. And that's the thing when we combine each other, it's, we give 1,000% with the show, you know, cause we both, you know, put the money in for the lights. We want to do the best we can for the lights and the background, you know, on the stage. And I think they know they're going to get a good, their money's worth and a good show.
That's
Jason.
Right.
Jason mentions that your legacy bands. I don't know that any band can exist for 40 plus years and still draw and still have a great fan base if you're jerks. I think like you can hide that for a couple of years.
Yeah, it's
but
true.
I think your rap is your rap, and I think the reason why those bands last generationally is because you do encounter your fans, and you know there's a theory that if something bad good happens, somebody will tell four friends. If something bad happens, they'll tell 10 friends. So it's almost like you have to work twice as hard to get half the acknowledgement. And you guys have that rabid fan base. And I think it's a testament to great music first and foremost, because let's face it, if the songs aren't there, nobody cares. True. But then once they dig deeper past that first layer, they realize, oh my God, these are great guys too. And I think you root for guys like that. You want to root for people that are good people because they don't last 40 years. This is a here today, gone later today industry.
Right. I just wanted, Jason, getting back to kind of what you were asking initially, and bring Dave in on this because he was there. I got asked into the band. I was writing, I think you and I talked about this the other night. I was writing 21 pieces of music for this industrial film that I've been hired to just like do kind of a bed of music for. And right when I got this gig and I knew I wasn't going to sleep for 2 weeks, I get the call from, actually, I got it from Todd Sukerman, our drummer, who said, what are you doing, man? And you got to sit down. And I got, you know, what's going on? What is there something the matter? He goes, no, I just found out that JY and Tommy are going to offer you. He called it, he did a lot of sessions. He said, they want to give you the Styx chair, which is a very jazzbo statement to make, but because we don't say chair really, rock. You don't hear many rockers using that, but they want to give you the bass chair. So I said, okay. We went through a great conversation. I just thought it was amazing that Todd would be and want to call, because there's that special relationship between a bass player and a drummer. And definitely, Todd and I, our love fest started the first time I did a session with him in Los Angeles. And there's something about a drummer just hitting his drums when he's setting them up, that if he's got the shit, you know, you can tell immediately. And I'm in setting my stuff because I was going to be in the control room, and I heard him tuning up, and I said, hey, who's the drummer on this session? Well, that's Todd Sukerman. He's the drummer in Styx, and I've been hearing about him. Okay, enough about that. But he said, listen, I wanted to make sure, what are you going to say? Do you have time? Would you do this? Would you want to do this? Do you want to go back on the road? And he said, Tommy's got to call you here in about 10 minutes, but I wanted to ask JY and Tommy if I could be the first one to call you. So cut to, I have the conversation with Tommy, and I'll just shorten that one up by saying that the end of the conversation, Tommy said, please don't say yes to this if you just want to try it out for a couple of years, because we're going to rock until we drop. And that's what I needed to hear. And as soon as he told me that, because that was my concern, are you guys just going to do this for a few years and then hang up the dancing shoes? And so now, as we were just saying, it's been 17 years later. But David, here's the story. You remember at the bowling alley in Hollywood?
Yeah.
It was Tommy's 50th birthday party. And Tommy said, why don't you come to my birthday party, and then you can meet every guys in the crew. You can meet our manager, and you can, and because I knew Tommy really well, but I really didn't know JY, and I didn't know Lawrence. And so I get to this party, and I've been told, don't say anything to anybody. We can't release this to the press at all. So don't tell anybody that what's going on.
Yeah, me.
And then what did you say to me? I after about 20 minutes of being there, Dave sneaks over the corner next to me, and he goes, you got something you want to tell me?
Yeah. We've been friends for, you know, 25 years at that. I'm like, oh, well, 20 years, whatever. And I said, what's going on here? You want to come on.
But it was just a wonderful night, because I got finally a chance to talk to JY and really find out and make sure and see that he was supportive, and that, man, you know, there were people who were checking me out, especially, it wasn't the band guys. It was it was like crew guys or you know, they want to make sure they were so careful and so protective of their boys, the guys in the band, that they put me through the ringer. But it was good. I did look around that room though, and you can attest to this, David. Every great out of work bass player was at that point. So I went, okay, I guess I better not fuck this up. You know?
Yeah.
Well, here you are 17 years later. It's a testimony to you.
First, I was a little mad, but I was happy at the same time. You know what I mean? I was like, he didn't tell me that, you know, really? He didn't tell me that. I went, well, he's in. All right, let's get, you know, it's great. Happy for him.
Well, that's credibility to your character, Ricky. Hey, and as far as your fans go, I've been holding this comment here. This came in like 5 minutes ago, and I really wanted to highlight this one here.
Okay.
So Vicky here has seen Styx with every member in the band. Love you all 61 times have been members. She's seen Styx 61 times.
Wow.
That's a fan. Yeah. It might be a stalker.
Yeah. That is.
I'm just messing with you, Vicky. That's great.
They hold these signs up, Jason, that, you know, this is my, you know, whatever the number is, show. And they hold them up out in the audience. And I think the highest one I've seen, and there's probably people who have been more times, 256 was the one I recall.
Wow.
That, and I'm thinking, yeah.
That's unbelievable. Well, look, I'm going to do something very special during the show here. So if any of you fans out there watching would actually like to come here onto the stream and quickly say hello, ask a question. Paul's back now. He had a delivery at the door or something. Yeah. But if any of you fans want to come on and actually say hello to the guys and ask a question, I'm going to open this up and allow you to do it. Now, the way to do that is you're going to need to send me a private message to the Facebook page that I run. So you'll have to look it up. It is called Live Streams with Famous Friends by Jason McNamara. As soon as you type in Live Streams with, it should be probably the only option that will come up on Facebook. Send a message to that page and I will send you back a link. Preferably, if you're not doing it on an iPhone or what have you, and you're doing it on a computer, please use Google Chrome because it's the only platform that runs carefully. Just follow the instructions. It's really easy to get onto the show. And there will probably be a little bit of a lineup of people backed up to come onto the show, so please be patient, but I'll try and get through people. Just also be quick. Try and come on for just a few minutes and move along, because that way we can try and let a few people come on and ask a question or say hello or say thank you or whatever it is that you guys want to say.
And just what a great opportunity that is, too.
Well, yeah. It's part of, you know, why I do this show. I want to spread positivity and love. That's the whole point of this show. Just remember, be respectful, because I have control over the show and I can kick you out of the stream real quick.
I think you were trying to. I tried to use that one. That didn't work.
No, I wouldn't kick you out. Come on, mate. It's all good. Now, there's something else that the three of us in particular have in common, and it's our love of double neck guitars.
Oh.
Either of you got one of your double necks handy? Ricky, do you have that 12-string, 6-string that you play when you're not playing bass in the show there in the room with you?
I have one that's like it, except it's pearl gray instead of pearl white. Hang on. Let me see if I can
go in the. I have to go in the closet.
Hang on.
That sounds bad, doesn't it?
Not necessarily.
Nah.
We'll welcome you when you come back out of the closet with open arms, Dave.
We're not judging.
Thanks, Jason.
This is great. You know, when you send off musicians to go get a guitar, it's like the roulette wheel, and you have no idea what's coming back, but well, you know it's going to be good.
I've got mine ready, so I'm going to wait and see what happens. So this is funny. So
you got yours, really?
Hell yeah, I've got mine ready.
Hang on. I've got to tell you this. This is the worst. I think about this all the time. It's maddening, and I sold this guitar 30 years ago. The kid came over, he traded me a Strat and some just jive guitar. I had a 1962 double neck 6 bass Gibson that was very rare because it had a right here. It had this little plate and it said fuzz with a big Z and then a little Z with this line, the lines through it. And it was ran on 2 penlight batteries. And, oh, wait a minute. Did I lose all y'all?
No. I just highlighted you. That's
highlighted. Okay. But this is a pearl gray.
This is an Italia, isn't it?
Yeah, it's an Italia. And you know what? I very easily could pop some hotter pickups in here and I may do that, but just right out of the box, it's actually pretty decent. I was looking at Gibsons, I was looking at all kinds of stuff, And I thought, I'm playing this on one song. It's going to be on the road, right? So they, because I started playing it and I liked it so much. Now, there you go. That's the real deal right there.
Ah.
That's the real deal right there. So they gave me this one just to have at home. And I use it. It's nice sounding little guitar.
I feel inferior.
So what kind of pickups are in that Ibanez?
They're actually the stock pickups, and you know what? I don't want to change them. I really like them. They're actually Ibanez USA pickups. So in the 12-string, it's an F1 and an F2. And then over here, we've got an F1 and an F2 with a C3 here. But they're actually American-made Ibanez pickups that were made back in... So this is a 1991 original, this guitar. Being that you guys are guitar geeks, you'll love this. That's not the original bridge. This is actually... Dave, you ready for this? This is a locking tremolo piezo bridge.
What? I've never heard of that.
So, Gibson do it on the Access guitar, on the Alex Lifeson signature guitar. So you've got essentially a piezo acoustic bridge on the locking trem. And I've put underneath the bridge here, I've actually got two sensors underneath here so I can have acoustic on the 12 string as well.
Wow. So that's a Floyd Rose with a piezo?
Yeah, so it's an Ibanez Edge. Actually, you know what? I'll put it on the other camera here because it's a nicer camera and you'll be able to see it a little bit better, and I can zoom with this one as well. I believe, hang on, which button? There you go, it's that button there. So I can zoom in here. That is an Ibanez Edge trim. Come on, focus, camera.
It was at 1 hour and 10 minutes that the show went nerd.
There you go.
Full nerd.
Exactly. So they're actually piezo sensors on there, Dave.
Okay.
So I've got the electric guitar output there, and on the back, I've got a second output so I can actually run the acoustic out of that output right there. I can run them simultaneous.
What does that middle pickup sound like? It looks like a single coil. Is that a single coil?
Yeah, thing? It is. Yes. Yeah, so okay. It's a single coil in the middle. So cool. I love this guitar. This is a very rare one because like Ibanez made these only in 1990 and 1991, and they only made a very small handful in red. So I think between the 2 years, they only made about 50 of these. And being that I live in Japan and I speak Japanese as well, I actually have met Imafuku-san, who's the guy who actually built this guitar.
Wow, nice.
So, and he works up at the Fujigen factory still to this day. And I showed him some pictures of this. We met at a trade show, and he was like, oh, my God, you've got one of them. That's insane. But the red, to the best that anyone can think, they only made about 5 of them in red, and I got one of them.
Wow.
That is really cool. I think I have an Ibanez double neck from, I don't know what year, you might know what year this is.
I would from the serial number. Tell us about yours, Dave, because you got a pretty auspicious double neck.
This is the Don Felder custom shop. I think it's 2010, if I'm not mistaken. And where is it? Where's signature Don? Whoops. How do I do that?
I'll light you up.
Oh, there you are. There you
go. So you got number 46, right?
50. Yep.
That's incredible. Only 50 of them made, and you got number 46. I actually remember the guitar shop I was working at in Tokyo, we were actually selling those. We had one of them at one stage.
It's amazing. It's the best. I have a 4 double necks, and this is the by far the best one. I mean, it's just amazing how they did this one. They just really, because they only made 50 of them, they just put, and it's exactly like, you know, Felder's. It has, you know, age in the back is stain, whatever, you know, whatever he had, they put some cracks in it. It's really
knock for knock,
exactly. Yep.
That looks like Ricky, a lawsuit Ibanez that Ricky's holding.
Yeah,
there.
Actually, it might even be a little bit before.
Yeah, look at that.
Oh, look at that. Yeah.
So it's a good bass. Old.
Yeah.
So Ricky, can you show me the back of the headstock so I can see the serial number?
There is no serial number.
In that case, then that's probably roughly a 73, 74.
I think that would be right because I don't even remember when or, to be honest, I can't remember how I got this, who I bought this from. I probably just saw it and made an offer and somebody, I haven't really ever, there's some work I wanted to get done to it because there's a broken piece here. But I remember these pickups being on other guitars and they sounded really good. So, but I can't tell you how it sounds, honestly.
I love those old guitar bass combo double necks. Those things are fantastic.
Yeah.
Like we used to call them a good bass.
Yeah, we have them. The old Rickenbackers? Ooh.
Yeah.
Nice.
I've actually seen, so here's a funny story about one of those. Alex Lifeson from Rush walked into the shop that I used to work at in Tokyo one day. That video's got over 600,000 views on YouTube and is very popular. I still get comments on it almost every single day. And Geddy Lee actually saw the video of that and contacted me at the store through his tech, mind you. Geddy didn't contact me directly, but his tech did. And when Scully, that's his tech, hit me up, we were like doing some video calls and I was showing him the bass. We had an original 1962 jazz bass that Geddy ended up buying off of us at the store, which is actually featured in his beautiful big book of bass. It doesn't have a massive feature, but it's in there. That's the main thing. And he bought it from me, which is really cool. But while Scully and I were doing the whole, like, going over the guitar and showing him bits and pieces, the bass rather, and showing him bits and pieces, Scully goes to me and one mate at the store who was a big Rush fan as well. We're on my iPhone doing a Skype call. He goes, just hang on one sec. He disappears, comes back, and he had Geddy's double neck Rickenbacker that he showed us on the video, which was just insanely cool to see.
Nice.
Yeah. I'd love to have one of those. I bought five Rickenbackers last year, but they were four strings.
Now, what's the neck dive like on a double neck? I don't own a double neck. I have a bunch of guitars, don't own a double neck. What's the double neck? What's the neck dive like on one of those?
It's like an SG.
Yeah. But more?
No. He means as far as like when you're holding it up, does the neck tilt down while you're trying to hold it up?
Yeah, the weight of it. I mean, yeah, the neck dive on those things, like on any SG, the neck dive is going to be, the weight is just going to knock that thing down. It's got to be that much more on a double neck.
It's pretty good. I mean, no, it holds up pretty even, to be honest, because the body weighs some, so it's, you know, it's pretty even. Pretty even. I've got a black one that's maybe a little headstock heavy. You know, it's heavier than this one, but this Felder is they really made this thing amazing. It's an amazing guitar.
Yeah, they're insane. I have enough time with one neck, much less two.
Okay,
look at that one. It's holding up.
Yeah, it looks good.
It's nice. Oh, yeah, there you go.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a beautiful guitar. I love this thing.
It's a tune.
Yeah, I tuned it. Mind you, Ibanez is staying tuned much better than what, let's just say, other brands might.
Oh, okay. Well,
they do, though.
Doesn't have that GB split at the headstock. You know how that goes. Try keeping that G string in tune on any Gibson.
So
it's tough.
There's you know, I'll change over to the other camera here. Here's the bridge. Oh, sorry, wrong one. Got too many options.
You know what I'm talking about.
Bridge pickup sound. And then the neck pickup. And then the middle pickup.
Oh. That middle's nice and rich. Yeah, that's rich.
You're allowed to play Stairway when you're on a double neck.
Yeah. It's a beautiful round sound too.
And then on the six string side of things, if I play the neck pickup for a comparison, and Ricky was asking about the middle single coil, if it's just a little bit out of tune, and then if I go to the bridge pickup, and then I'll do a split between the bridge single and the neck, sorry, in the middle single.
Yeah,
that's nice.
It really has a nice sound. Sure. And then that's the next single and the middle single together. And then just as a straight-up rock guitar, I mean, it's a killer, killer sounding guitar. Actually, hang on. Here we go. You know, I can't help myself. I got to play this riff now. So Paul knows what that is. Do you two guys know what song that is?
I don't know what that is.
Dave?
Not sure.
That's Don't Tread on Me by the Damn Yankees.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's Tommy and Ted and Jack and Michael Cardelloni, man. I love the Damn Yankees. So like even with the Damn Yankees stuff, man, like the Silence Is Broken was done on a 12-string as well. So even though it's not normally that screechy.
I'm sure Dave has an Uncle Ted story of two that nobody will ever hear.
Well, I was just,
Go on, let's hear it.
I was just going to say a good lead-in to Ted, which again is connected to Ricky Phillips. Ricky Phillips.
There's so many things that are connected between the two of us in our careers. It's funny because I never thought about it at the time. Go ahead, though.
Ricky, I mean, you could probably say it better than I. You knew the Doug Banker, the manager, and
I have been asked to play two songs on Ted's Little Miss Dangerous record. He had one song that was going to be in a movie, and the other one was going to be the single, and he was playing bass on the record itself.
Right.
So I went down and I cut those two tracks, and he was saying, "Man, you got to know somebody. I'm looking for a singer, and I'm trying to think, who do I know?" And like none of the guys I knew that were just singers, I could think of. There was one guy, and I threw his name out, and I probably shouldn't have, because it really wasn't a good fit. But I thought, Dave, if you want another guitar player, and you're okay with that, I know this guy's a great guitar player. He says, yeah, give me his name. So Banker called you up, didn't he? Or did I call you up? Yeah, Banker called you up. And Doug Banker was an old friend of mine. He was Ted's manager, and came down, and the next thing I know, I left after my two songs were done. Dave stayed there for the next month finishing the record with Ted, and then I came back and sang some songs with you guys, harmonies and stuff.
Yeah, that's right.
Then all of a sudden I'm running into Ted Dave on the road because he was out with Ted. Who's I with? Oh, was that with John Parr, wasn't I?
Yeah.
And I ran into you in Detroit and a few other cities. Yeah.
Yeah, in a hotel or something with Brett Tuggle or something. Crazy. It was fun. The 80s were fun days.
Yeah.
So to put that together for those of you out there who are going, hang on, so am I getting this right? Did Dave actually sing with Ted Nugent? Well, he did. This is Heels in Motion from the Little Miss Dangerous record, and this is Dave Amato singing with Ted.
Oh, boy.
Some pretty high harmonies there.
Yeah.
High heels in motion.
It's weird because those
rock 80s out, you were playing guitar and singing with Ted.
Those 80s Nugent records get overlooked. They're a Little Miss Dangerous, and If You Can't Lick 'Em, and they're great records. You know, they're certainly of their time, but great records. You know, no worse or you know, unnotable than any of their peers. I mean, they're good records.
No, there's some good stuff on it, you know. Especially that one was like my first record with him. It wasn't bad at all. It was good.
Did you tour that record was it Aerosmith?
Yeah, 1986. Yeah. We did a Little Miss Dangerous in 5 months with Aerosmith. We went out in March and we never came back till like September.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a great year for me. I think I came home for 2 days. Just even, you know, got a cold or something.
Really hungry.
But yeah, 5 months straight, you know. And when Ted toured, he used to say, you know, you better kiss your babies and your wife and your animals, and because Once Ted Nugent goes out on the road, we don't come back. You know, he'd like to. Once he got on the road, man, we stayed on the road. It's never like breaks to come back. No, we just stayed out there.
Yeah, he doesn't know the word stop in anything.
Nope.
At all. I mean, it's 100, 150 miles an hour. Go until you hit something.
Yeah, I love the man. It was so great for me to watch him, and he was still huge. You know, huge and putting on great arena shows in the. In the 80s, it was really a fun time for me to be there. It's great.
So what is Ted like just as a regular dude when he's not being Ted that we see in the public? Is he still exactly the same, like really high wired guy, or does he actually have like a half volume, or he's just Ted all the time?
No, he has a down volume for sure. He was a good father. I stayed at his house, you know, we used to, he'd have a chick. He'd have a, he's really kind of a farmer, you know. He had a farm and then a bunch of dogs and animals and chicken. He had a hen out with chickens, and he'd go, you know, he'd say, "Hey, Amato, want Ted to cook you up some breakfast?" And I'd say, "Sure, Ted." You know, so he'd go out to the hen house and get fresh eggs, and he'd make me breakfast. And well, of course, wild boar bacon. You know, he'd go out and have bacon. Sure, Ted. Whatever, you know. But it was good. No, he was a great guy, and he's a good friend. I really know the man, you know, from spending a lot of time with him. On that note, you know, so.
So aside from singing harmonies, Ricky, did you ever play with Ted as well?
You know, I did some things just like with Dave and Ted, like a NAMM show or some, but I never performed with them live or anything. I mean, you know, not in a show. We've toured together. The Babies, we toured with Ted. We had Ted out with us. When was that, Dave? Like 5-6 years ago?
Yeah, with Styx, REO, and Ted. Yeah.
And, you know, we've been friends for, you know, really we met, he called me up and he left the craziest, I still have it somewhere. I remember when we had those little answering machines with the little tiny cassette thing that went in. I saved that thing because it had Ted and some other people on it leaving me messages that were, I've got to save it. And I've got to find out buy one of the, something that plays that little cassette on, because I need to copy it off. But he left the most hysterical message telling me to come on down, and he needed me to play on his record and do these two songs for him, and that led to a friendship. But I was already friends with kind of his inner circle, and he knew me and had seen me play live before, but we'd never really guys like that are wound up like that. I'm pretty like standoffish with people who are like a 14-story personality, so it was him calling me before we really became friends.
No, he's as alpha male as it gets.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But he's a good guy. Let me tell you. He's a good guy.
And one of rock's most underappreciated guitar players.
Oh, you know what? He's a Hall of Famer to me, you know, for my vote. He should be a Hall of Famer. Come on. Come on.
Even just on the strength of Stranglehold alone, I mean, that riff just sends shivers down my spine. It's such a great song.
He was one of the big three for about 4 years in the 70s in the United States. It was him, Ace Frehley, and Peter Frampton were like the guys.
They played stadiums.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. No, he was massive, and again, still puts out every night when he goes out on stage. And it's the amount of incest, musical incest that goes on. Like, I wouldn't know that Ricky had sang some harmonies on these records. And like, have you guys ever done sessions or been on records that nobody knows you're on?
Let's get back to that in a second. Sorry to cut that off, but we've got some fans waiting here to say hello.
So
please remember to bring that up again in a moment, Paul.
Right.
But I'm going to let these guys introduce themselves, because I can see the name is Scott Pranky, but I can't see the full name. And here we go. Hello, folks.
Hey, Scott.
Hello.
How are you?
How you doing?
So Scott and Marie here.
How are you doing?
That's not the button. That's the button. One.
Hey, Marianne.
How you
going? Hi, Ricky.
Sorry, Marianne, not Marie. Hey, guys. Oh, you know these guys, do you?
Hey, wait. Scott, hold on.
Oh, say they know. Oh, okay.
There you go. Cheers.
Oh, look at that.
Okay.
It's 10:29 in the morning here in Tokyo, so I'm drinking water.
I'm with you, Jason.
It's 102 degrees here. I'm drinking water.
Well, welcome to the show, folks. So do you guys know each other here? Are you all personal friends or fans, or what's the story here?
We are both. We were fans first and have become friends and have golfed and had dinner and enjoyed Ricky's company and company of other members of the band.
Yeah.
Nice. Absolutely.
He's a good
some fine wine.
Yep, some good wine. The mission.
Yeah,
great new album. And Dave, I have to say, I saw you in Vegas. Well, I've seen REO quite a few times, but the last time that I saw you in Vegas, I think it was it could have been October of last year. But I'm telling you, your harmonies and Bruce's were just killer that night. I mean, just amazing.
Thanks, bud. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, very nice. Very nice. And I mean, what's that?
Scott's actually a drummer himself, and so don't let him just like hang back like he's just a fan. This guy knows music. he's paying you a compliment.
I have guitars too, but I'm still learning to play those right now. So I know you're showing some guitars, but I have to show you one that I recently picked up not long ago. But it's a Guild, and I think it's a 70s. But you guys might be able to figure it out. I think it's early 70s, maybe even early 80s. But
I notice he's sending the roadie to go and grab the guitar for you.
Yeah, Marianne's grabbing it for me.
You got your roadie. Oh, wait a minute. That's a blues bird.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes.
Blues bird.
Show us the serial number on the back of the headstock, if that's where it is? Because that'll usually help people who know to be able to figure things out.
Yeah, look at the top of the headstock. It should be
in
there.
I want that with Ibanez.
Oh, I had one in the 70s.
Okay.
Yeah, it's impossible to read that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't see it.
Okay.
Right? Blues bird, yeah.
Yes.
You know what I call it? Yeah.
Hang on. Let me highlight you on the screen. Give me one second here. I'll click the button. There you go. So bring that serial number back up to the front of the camera if you can.
Here, let me hold it.
Oh, there it is.
There you go.
Look at that. Oh, boy. Tough.
It's tough to see it.
You know, the way that that's looking with the way it's in the lacquer, though, I would say that would be more modern than 70s, because I don't recall 70s guitars doing etching into the headstocks of any guitars during those eras. That definitely looks like it's more modern than that.
Those are good guitars.
Yeah, it starts with a CL.
If that means anything.
Does it say on there where it's made?
Made in USA.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Yeah. They're good guitars, but not as good as Gibson.
Guild was owned.
Dave, what is the name of that crazy store that you took me to?
In Rochester?
Yeah.
Yes. House of Guitars.
House of Guitars. Scott lives right near there.
Oh, I love that place.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God, it's a mess of a great place.
Yes.
upstate New York?
Yes, Rochester. Yes.
Yeah, that's like a. Was it blue? Was that house blue?
Yes. 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 Yes.
I saw like really? I was on my way through Rochester, saw like a TV commercial for it. It was like, you know, your local like cable access TV commercial. It was one camera and this blue house and just big like the Chiron is House of Guitars, and that was it. It was literally a house full of guitars. I thought, well, all right, that makes sense.
It is. It's three stories. And then in the bottom, in the basement, it's a record store. I mean, right? What records? Just thousands
and thousands of records there.
Dave, the signed Paul McCartney there? That signed Paul McCartney? Wasn't I with you when you bought that?
Texan, yeah. The McCartney, you know, Paul played yesterday on.
Right.
He released mine signed in the hole. He signed. Right.
Yeah, that was there, wasn't it?
Yeah, I still have it. Yeah, the Texan.
Well, I'm sorry to push you guys on, Scott. But,
that's okay.
We've got another fan who's waiting to come on and say hello. We've got Susan and Rory waiting to come.
Cheers, everybody.
Thanks, Scott.
Take care. Great to see you again.
All right.
Bye, Ricky.
Be well. Bye.
We'll see you.
Thanks for coming in, guys. Have yourselves a wonderful wonderful evening and enjoy the wine.
You too. It's a great broadcast. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, please continue to follow the show. We appreciate it a lot. You know, we're trying to do this with as many people and give you guys unique experiences of what we can with this thing. So thank you very much.
Oh, it's very nice. It's a great learning experience for a lot of people. So it's a lot of fun listening to all the stories. So it's well worth it.
Cool. Thank you, buddy.
Thank you. Appreciate it. All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See ya.
All right. Next up, we have Susan and Rory. Susan, I know that you can hear me. They can't see you yet, but just put your phone sideways so that way it's doing the vertical thing. It just makes it better for the there we go. All right. Here we go. Please welcome Susan and Rory.
There's Susan. There's Rory.
Hey, Rory. Look, everybody's drinking wine.
Everybody's doing wine tonight.
Yeah. Good on you.
Yeah. What kind of wine is everybody drinking?
Actually, this is a Chateau Saint Michel from Indian Wells, and it's 2016, I think.
Oh, nice.
Yes.
I think ours is $4.99 a bottle at these rates.
Nice.
My
yeah,
one
thank
comes
you guys
in a box.
For doing this. This is great.
Yeah, Jason, Paul, and I are doing water. I kind of wish I was doing wine. Anyway.
Yeah, me too.
Sharesies.
Was there a question or something you wanted to ask the guys, Susan?
Well, they both treat their fans amazing, obviously. And we, me, and that guy... He was in England, and we were on Styx World back in the day before Facebook, and Rory created it, and 15, 20 years later, that was in 1999,
wow.
You've seen us, I'm sure.
Wow, yeah.
And I've been to 87, I think,
Styx
concerts, wow. And about 75 REOs.
Really?
Yeah. My question is for you guys, what are you doing in this pandemic to keep yourselves uplifted? besides the wine.
Go ahead, Dave.
Well, I don't know, I'm playing a lot of guitar, you know, kind of by myself here. Not much, to be honest with you. I don't know. Just I don't know. Go ahead, Rick.
I started up the first couple of weeks were kind of, and it's probably this, I've heard this from other people. I don't even remember those first 2 weeks because I had been on the road. I've never been at home this long in at least 17 years, maybe more.
Yeah, me too.
Since I've been a Styx. So, and so it was really weird. I don't even remember the first 2 weeks, but then I Melissa wanted this Nordic Track treadmill. And it was when Amazon was doing their, they were blowing everything out last year. And so I said, this is going to be a boat anchor in the house. Are you kidding? You sure you want, yeah, she wanted it. So we got it. And after that two sort of hazy, weird beginning of all this, I got up one morning and I ran 2.5 miles and it just about killed me and it pissed me off that it killed me. So I'm in my fourth week of getting up every morning and going and doing 2.5 miles before I do anything. Therefore, there's no excuses. I have to start my day after the 2.5 miles. And I take Sundays off, but I run 2.5 miles every morning on the Nordic Track. Come into my studio here where I am now and work on Styx stuff, work on my own stuff. Today I was working on my own stuff. Just record and record and record and write. And then, of course, there's a lot of stuff around the house that Melissa and I are always doing. And occasional. I only have left the house a couple times in 7 weeks. I'm one of those guys that wants to stay clean and not take it. Especially today, I heard that men are twice as likely to die from the corona than women. That kind of woke me up. But other than that, things are good. I mean, we have plenty to do around here. Melissa's a nurse, so she's doing her due diligence and serving her time. But as you guys know, elective surgeries. Hospitals are actually, unless you've got COVID patients, you know, they're kind of shut down around that. And so thank God she hasn't been in there every day like I thought she was going to be. And so far we're good. Yeah.
Yeah. Give her our love and tell her thank you very much for what she does.
I will. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you very much, guys, for popping in. I've got more people lined up here ready to come out and say hello. So enjoy your wine.
I love you guys. Thank you. Cheers.
Just quickly, where were you calling in from, by the way?
We are in Utah.
Oh, Utah. Okay.
Nice.
Yeah, we only had 3 shows canceled so far this year.
We're trying to push everything, you know, to the fall, you know.
Let's hope.
You know, yeah. Yeah, we don't know. We got some in July and August, and you know, we mostly put everything September, October, November, December, because all the stuff now we try to just throw it over there. But well, you know, we'll see what happens.
Yeah, it's exactly. Really sad not having our live music. Yeah. That's for sure.
We're sad.
You guys stay safe and stay strong, and we'll get through it.
Thanks.
Amen to
exactly.
that. Amen.
And let's hope the world becomes a more united place from it. All right, thanks, guys. Take okay. care and enjoy
Thank
your
you,
evening
Jason.
In Utah. Pleasure. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
You guys enjoying this? This is a bit of fun, getting yeah. a bit of yeah. outreach to fans.
Yeah.
Well, Paul's back now. Now, the next gentleman who's coming in is actually a dear friend of mine. He started out as a customer at the shop that I was working at. So the store I was working at, I showed you guys a little snippet the other day.
Yeah.
The shop that I was working at, for those of you who haven't seen it, it was called Ishibashi Music here in Japan. I'm actually the only foreigner in the history of Japan to actually successfully work in guitar shops out here. So the only one. I did 4.5 years at the store and made a bunch of videos at the store while I was there. And this gentleman here was a very, very dear customer who bought quite a few Gibson custom shops off of me. And just like Dave is a bit of a guitar collector. And he's here to say hello. So please welcome Mike from Michigan.
Michigan?
Yeah, man.
Hey, Mike.
Detroit, Motor City.
There you go.
Hello?
You there?
We can hear you, Mike. We can hear you fine.
Oh, you can hear me? Okay, I didn't know if you could hear me. How you guys all doing?
Doing good.
Hey, Mike.
I'll tell you what. The dude that wakes up at 5 o'clock in the morning every day, that's my rock star.
Yeah.
So, Jason, how are you?
I'm well, mate. I'm well. We got a little bit of a delay with you for some weird reason. It's strange. We're seeing your mouth move, and then a couple of seconds later, we're getting your voice. But don't worry about it. It's all good.
So, who are your guests today?
Well, you can see them right there. You can see everybody on the screen, can't you?
Man, I'm over 50, dude. I got to have these or I can't see nothing. that writing's about a 16th of an inch tall. Ricky? Is that right, Ricky?
Yeah, he knows who's being on the show. He's just being funny. You know I've got Ricky Phillips and David Amato on the show.
What is that? Neanderthal?
Yeah, Neanderthal.
Neanderthal.
Yes. Paul's co-hosting the show
so
with
Dave,
me today.
Yeah.
What's that?
Go ahead.
Dave, I got to ask you, being from Detroit, I'm most familiar with your work with Ted. I mean, like, Detroit and Ted, it's like one, right? How was it touring with Ted and hanging out with Ted and Charmaine?
Oh, it was awesome. It was, what a great experience for me. Yeah. I mean, I did like about three and a half years with them. Yeah, two records, big tour with Aerosmith. His wife is beautiful, great.
What albums did you record with him on?
Little Miss Dangerous, and If You Can't Lick 'Em, Lick 'Em.
Okay, cool. Well, Jason, if you don't mind, I'd like to just tell these fellas actually how we met real quick.
Yeah, definitely go for it. It's funny stories.
So I'm a hack guitar player. I mean, I just call it like I see it, right? And I'm a hack.
Thanks, Paul.
But I love guitars. I'm more of a collector than I am player. So I go to Gibson in Nashville and I pick out wood to have my own guitars built. And that's all good and fine. But I notice that all the Primo stuff goes to Japan, the Murphy painted and aged stuff and all that really killer, you know, 5A flame maple tops. So I had back surgery. I had my fifth back surgery on March the 17th of 2015. So I had a lot of time on my hands for the next year. Wasn't getting much sleep. So about 2 a.m, I said to myself, you know what? I'm going to go on one of them Japanese dealers' websites. I'm going to get their phone number. Never called Japan before. Don't know how to do it. Don't know if anybody will speak English, but I'm going to give it a whirl. So I called the number to the store he was working at. This really kind-hearted, non-speaking Japanese fellow had no sense of English. And all I was asking him is this: hello, do you speak English? I'm calling from the United States. And he would, in Japanese, you know, say, whatever he was saying. So we did this, him and I, for like 15 minutes. I kid you not, 15 minutes. Then he told me, well, I only know that he told me to hang on because when he clicked the phone button, there was music on hold. So obviously I knew he put me on hold. 20 minutes later, this fella comes on the phone. And we formed in the last 5 years quite a few relationships. I did a count the other day, just from him alone in Japan between 2015 and end of 2017. Can I say the number, Jason?
Sure, go for it.
67 custom shop Gibsons from Japan.
Hey. What the hell do you do for a living?
Nice.
He rubs banks.
No, I actually own a business that my father started in 1948 in Detroit.
Good for you.
We are a supplier to the automotive. We have a trucking company, and we do flatbed heavy haul. So we haul all of their steel to their stamping plants to get it stamped. And we also store that in our storage facility for them. It's a real just-in-time kind of thing. But
wow,
I was fortunate enough to meet Jason, and we have spent, even when I didn't buy guitars from him, I'd call him up and we would just spend hours on the phone. So true. He's a really good dude, as you guys know.
Thank you. Yeah, we've formed a very genuine friendship over the years. So
you guys got to forgive me. I'm not being sarcastic, but I just don't know. I mean, I know who Dave Amato is, but I don't know Ricky or Neanderthal. So what do you guys do?
Musicians.
Ricky okay. plays bass in Styx, Mike.
Styx. Yeah, Ricky is the bass player for Styx.
Styx.
Okay, Styx, right on. So are you one of the original members from Styx, or?
No.
Okay.
Just to help give some context, Mike actually hadn't been watching the show. He actually text messaged me on my phone, and I sent him back and said, hey, if you want to quickly jump on, because I can't talk to you right now, I'm on the show with Dave and Ricky, but if you want to quickly jump on and say hello, you're quite welcome to. So he hasn't caught all the backstory of what we've been seeing on the show so far.
All right.
Now, you know what, Mike, I'm going to have to kick you because we got two more people sitting here in the background who are waiting to come on and say hello. So I've got to let them come through as well.
Yeah, man. Nice chat.
I'll call you after the show.
Well, Mike.
All right.
Mike, here's a plug. Why don't you check out some of my custom shop guitars? I got two signature model Gibsons, Les Pauls.
From what years?
Well, they're new. They're new. They're custom shop. The last couple of years, yeah. Check them out.
Oh, you mean, how do I check them out?
You can go to the Gibson website and go into the signature.
I'll fill him in on it later. It's cool. I'll take care of it later on.
Okay.
All right, yeah. Excellent.
I'll have Gibson get in touch with me. We got a really bad delay, and the signal's really breaking up.
Yeah, all good.
Okay.
All right,
man. Nice chat.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I'm just going to have to cut it. It's just not working out for some reason. He's got a bad connection, and it's the way it goes. We have REO Gina. I love this one. REO Gina.
REO Gina, yeah.
Love the name.
There you go.
Gina.
Right. How you doing, Dave?
Hi, Gina. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
Now, if I remember correctly, REO Gina has seen you guys like 150 times or something like that.
105 times.
105. I almost said to you, because Ricky has what? How many, Ricky? 265?
No, it was like, this was a few years ago. Somebody.
I've seen Styx 68 times. I've seen REO 105 times.
Wow. Good for
my
you.
My two favorite bands.
Bless you.
Unfortunately, the last time I seen REO was in San Juan, Puerto Rico. I flew there from Ohio. October 25th, Dave.
Yeah.
You guys need to get back on the road because I've got tickets for 7 shows this year, so I'm ready.
Did any of them cancel? I mean, any of the ones you're going to cancel are pushed?
Well, the one that got canceled was at the Indy 500 where I was going to see both bands, REO and Styx.
That's the one. Yeah, the Indy 500. Yep.
Yeah. Then I have 5 pushed out to, postponed to October and December. and one in Louisville, Kentucky, July 31st. That hasn't, I haven't got anything on yet.
No, no, I'm like this. Okay. Come on.
I have not missed an REO show since 1978. We can't do this. I'm having withdrawals, man. Can't do it. Got to get on the road.
But believe Ricky and I, we're dying over here.
We're working on it.
I got a picture of you and me in San Juan backstage with my shirt on that says my 105th REO concert. I don't know if you remember that.
I remember. Yeah, sure.
There you go. Gina. I keep count. So, yeah, first time I seen REO, I was 13 years old.
Gina.
So, yeah. And, I got stuck out of the house with my older brother and got caught, but it was well worth the punishment.
Ricky wants to ask you something.
So
go ahead, Ricky.
Going back to the Indianapolis 500.
What's up, Ricky?
Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can you hear me? Oh, she can't hear me.
Technical glitches, folks.
Okay. Now, I had a question because the Beatles.
I can answer any REO Styx question you got. Give it to me.
All right. Well, can you hear me? Can you hear me talking?
I don't think Ricky hears me.
No.
I wanted to correct you guys on the show you was talking about with, you said like 5 years ago with REO Styx and Ted Nugent.
Mm-hmm.
That was in 2011, the Midwest Rock and Roll Tour.
Okay.
Because I've seen that show 3 times.
Wow.
You got to remember, I fly anywhere, I drive anywhere, I put a lot of miles to come see both bands. I don't care where you are, I'm coming to see you guys.
We got great fans, Jason. We have great fans.
No joke. That's huge.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, like I said, it doesn't matter to me. But my question is, and I don't know if you guys would know the answer to this, a little bit of history here. So if you go way back to the 70s in Illinois, when the Battle of the Bands and all this was going on, everybody, well, me, because my two favorite bands, REO and Styx, was really big rivalries, real big rival bands. And people like me never thought I would see my two favorite bands ever on the same stage because of the rivalry back in the day. You guys finally came together and it was a trip when you guys came together for the Arch Allies tour.
Wow.
And I thought that's the correct Arch Allies first time you guys toured together.
2000, I think. 2000.
Yes, Arch Allies tour.
Yeah.
So my question is, do you guys, and I don't care if you guys are original members or not, God bless you guys. You guys have kept these bands going. Dave, people say you had big shoes to fill with Gary Richrath, Long Live GDR. Man, you have filled those shoes. We give you and Brian Hitt credit. The fans do.
Oh, nice.
Well, your guys' loyalty to the band is what's kept REO going. And if they wouldn't found the loyalty in you two, I don't know where REO would be. I don't know if they'd be out there. So just know that the fans love you guys. I know this. You guys were talking about how fans know each other so much. I'm kind of getting a loyal following. Like if I'm at shows, people are yelling at me. Like everybody knows me at these shows. I also run a Facebook page. I'll start one for Styx. I have a Facebook page with over 2,500 members. It's called REO Speedwagon for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Right. I've seen it.
And, that's my page.
Okay.
So, yeah. So we're pushing really hard and doing everything we can. We're writing letters to the Hall of Fame. You don't want to hear the bullshit reasons they give us, but whatever. We'll keep pushing. Don't worry. We'll keep pushing.
I'm
going to get you guys in.
My thing is,
with the rivalry back in the day and with all the battle of the bands back in Illinois then, I mean, it was almost like a understanding that the two bands didn't get along at all. What finally broke the ice between the two bands that made you guys finally come together for Arch Allies, where people like me finally got to see my favorite two bands on the same stage when for 20, 30 years, I never thought I'd see that. Do you know how that finally came about?
Well, I'm not really sure, you know, just that's an old rivalry, you know, but I don't think they were like at each other's throats. I think they respected each other and, you know, it's just, they're both from Chicago, which, you know, they're both Chicago bands, you know, there's a chemistry and there's a brotherhood in Chicago. I've got to tell you that, you know, from also, I don't know if it was such a, it was just maybe a competition, you know,
hear me.
Said, if you hear the stories back in the day, it was a huge competition. Like I said,
Gina, let's just check here. Ricky, what were you going to say? And let's hope that she can hear you.
What I was going to say, hey, Ricky, I would guarantee you that it had nothing to do with the people who are in both bands now. And you know, time does heal everything. But I mean, there's a lot of love between the original members of both bands.
Yeah. Ricky said there's a lot of love between the original members of REO and Styx, and that holds true for sure. You know,
that's good to hear, because like I said, I can tell you the story I heard. There was a show on MTV, was called Rock and Roll Jeopardy. Does any of you guys remember that?
No.
It was called Rock and Roll Jeopardy, and it was just like the Jeopardy show, but all rock and roll questions. And I watched that episode, and Kevin and Tommy was on that show. And the story I heard is when they was on that show, and this was late 80s, early 90s, that they were talking backstage, and that was what broke the ice, that they just kind of looked at each other and was talking about touring together. And even they was like, why haven't we never toured together? And I think that was sometime in the 90s. So if you guys heard anything like that, that's what I heard broke the ice, was when they went on that show on MTV. It was called Rock and Roll Jeopardy.
They're very close friends.
So maybe that's what broke the ice. I don't know. But
well, Ricky just said they're very close friends. Unfortunately, we're having a technical issue here with the fact that you can't hear Ricky, which is like strange, because the rest of us can all hear him anyway. But he said they're close friends. Anyway, Gina, I'm going to have to move it along, because I've got another person who's sitting here very patiently waiting in the background.
But thanks for letting me on. I love you guys. Dave, I really hope to see you guys soon. I told everybody the other day, I've officially been diagnosed with REO Speedwagon and Styx withdrawal, so we need to get it going, man.
All right.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much.
As soon as we can, we'll be back.
Yeah, real quickly, what happened?
I'm going to hold you to that. I'll be there.
Okay.
Go on,
thanks,
Paul.
Thanks, guys.
I was going to say, what happens, you know, and I don't think people understand this sometimes, is when bands are coming up, there's a scene and there's that competitive nature and stuff. And I don't think there's any animosity. I don't think there was ever any animosity between the two bands. I just think that both bands are trying to get recognized. They're trying to get on stage in front of big clubs and big crowds. And I mean, that's natural. That's healthy. And I think it perpetuates a great music scene. So you've been very, very lucky to deal with that in the Chicago area.
And what a lot of people don't realize about the music industry is it's very rarely the actual bands and the band members themselves. Unfortunately, there's a lot of behind the scenes bullshit with managers, promoters, somebody in the background who usually holds control over these things has some sort of a grievance with somebody, and that bleeds in, and bands are stuck having to defend themselves when it's not even an issue that they even created themselves. And that happens far too, and it happens in everywhere. You could work in an office and somebody who deserves the promotion doesn't get the promotion because someone else got a nepotistic thing with a nephew or a niece or what, and it just gets in the way. It's exactly the same thing with bands. So
exactly. I'm an essential. I'm still working. I'm a site manager. So I've moved my way up the ladder as far as the competition. I totally understand that. And my personal opinion is, Ben, they were so young at the time, it was just competition. It was, because when you guys are on stage together now, the fans have fun because they can tell you guys are having so much fun up there, and it just literally exuberates. I mean, it just comes out to the crowd. I don't know if you guys see it from the stage, how much fun we're having. We're having fun because we're seeing the fun that you guys are having.
That's great.
Exactly.
Perfect.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks again for your time, Gina. I've got to move on because poor Dennis is sitting here waiting. But thank you very much.
Thank you. Hope to see you guys soon.
All right.
Keep rocking.
Yeah, thanks.
You know what? Without here's a reality. Without a fan like Gina out there, nobody would have a career. And God bless those people for that. But it's just unfortunately for the people who are coming, because Dennis, who's in the background, is pissing himself laughing at me too right now. Yeah. For the people who are coming onto the show, we need to keep it a little brief, because otherwise we're going to be sitting here for days on end, and I can't take up too much of Ricky and Dave's time. They're very generous to come here and do this with us. So we'll maybe do one more fan and then see how we go from there and get back into our story. So, Dennis, thank you very much for being patient. It's great to see a young fan on the show.
Dennis Atlas.
Hey, Dennis. What's up? Hey, guys. Oh, my gosh.
Ricky, is this your son?
What?
I said, Ricky, is this your son? He kind of looks like he could be related.
Well, you know, I don't know. He doesn't know this, so this is not the time to bring it up.
Awkward.
So, Dennis, tell us, where are you calling from and how old are you?
Well, I'm 22. I'm calling from Santa Clarita.
California.
Yeah, and what's funny is I think both of these guys know this. I play in a tribute band to both Styx and REO Speedwagon.
I did know that.
Two separate bands.
Wow.
Yeah.
Is it REO Styx Wagon?
That would be cool. They're actually two different bands, and we started the Styx one first, and then I met this guy. I don't know. Dave, I think you know Rick Hunter, maybe?
Oh, Rick. Oh, yeah. He plays like five different bands, right? He plays in Leonard Skinner and copy bands, whatever.
Yeah, so he called me up, and he's like, hey, do you want to play? Yeah. What was that?
Tribute bands.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he called me up and asked if I wanted to kind of be the Kevin Cronin role in an REO Speedwagon tribute band. And I was like, heck yeah. So, I mean, this stuff is built into my DNA. I first saw Styx when I was 6 years old. And I think it was Ricky had just joined the band. It was December 2003. And then I saw REO for the first time with Styx in 2005. So I was like, I don't know, 8 or 9. So yeah, I've been a fan for a very long time.
Dennis, there's a delay. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So
yeah, I can hear you.
There is a picture that I don't even remember, but it's of you and me at a NAMM show. And how old were you at that NAMM show?
That's a good question. I think I want to say that was like 2006, right? So I would have been 9.
Okay. So that makes sense because I have a recollection of you in Vegas. I have a recollection of you at several shows, but then I saw that picture and it flashed me out because I recognized you immediately. You haven't changed that much, really. You look the same. and I thought, oh my God, I have known Dennis since he was 9 years old. Okay, all right. And you came to the first show when you were 6.
Yeah. It was the Cyclorama tour.
You should hear him sing, Dave.
Wow.
He can hit the notes and he can play piano. He's a badass on piano. He's a badass on guitar.
I think I've seen one or two videos with REO or something real quickly or something. I didn't know that was you doing Kevin.
Well, you know what? Now that we've made the connection here on the show, because Dave doesn't live too far from you, maybe you'll be lucky and Dave will get up and jam on stage with you guys one night.
That's what I'm hoping. That was my plot all along here.
Oh, I see. Yeah. I see.
Okay.
Yeah, man.
He's smart for 22.
Yeah. Huh? What was that?
I said they're pretty clever for 22.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's what happens when you're a Styx and REO fan, you know.
Oh, well, that's good.
The plot thickens.
Yeah.
That's what that was. Okay, so I have a question. Why I did that. I thought of a question because I was going to be on here.
Go for it.
So you guys have both done so much stuff, obviously outside of Styx and REO Speedwagon. I was wondering if there was one thing you could be remembered by, musically speaking, that isn't Styx or REO Speedwagon, what would you want it to be? Like a second, obviously.
Hmm. Okay, now are you talking about accomplishments as a musician or things that I still wish I could do that I haven't done, or I'm not quite getting the question exactly.
Oh, like something you've done, an album or something that like you would want people to know as well as your work in Styx and REO Speedwagon.
Oh, well, for me, that's probably pretty easy because I did a record a couple of years ago that I produced. It was the last recordings of Ronnie Monza.
10 by 10, right?
10 by 10. And there's so many of my friends on this record. It started off, be real quick, because this is a long story, so I'll make it this big. Myself, Ronnie Montrose, and then Eric Singer, the drummer with Kiss, he's done a lot of stuff, but he's known really as a drummer with Kiss for the last, 35, 38 years, whatever it is. We had these songs in the can, and Ronnie died. So here we had all these songs, and they were unfinished. So it was kind of put upon me, I'll just make it, cut it to a quick story, to finish it and produce it and get people in to come in. Ronnie had done all the guitars except for the solos. So 92% of the guitars on the record are Ronnie Montrose. And so that's why the record is so lush and wonderful. But
wow,
I brought in Ronnie's friends to finish. Sammy Hagar had already written before I took it over with Ronnie. They wrote the lyrics of one song. All of Sammy's lyrics were done. Edgar Winter's contribution on saxophone and B3 and his incredible vocals were on a track. I brought in Tommy Shaw. I brought in Glenn Hughes. I brought in Steve Lukather, Joe Bonamassa, a lot of people to help finish this record. And Mark Farner was already there that Ronnie brought in. I play a lot of Hammond B3, which is that Hammond B3 right behind me on this record. And I play some piano, some incidental guitar parts, because when you've got basic tracks, there are certain things that need to, the little sugar coatings on songs.
Sure.
But generally, the connection with everybody on this record is they had to have had the approval of Ronnie Montrose at some point. And I stayed very, very true to that. And I told every guitar player, I said, remember, no shredding. This is a Ronnie Montrose record. Ron used to say that a guitar solo should be like sex. You never start with the frenzy. You work to the frenzy. And so that was the little note that I gave all the guitar players. Got it. We're on the record, but everybody just did an amazing job. And I hope I answered your question, but that's a record.
Yeah.
I could go into the reasons why it isn't better known. It came out at a very odd time, and there were some backstory things of what happened. The money stopped from the record company, unfortunately, because we had three delays in its time release. Otherwise, I think it would have been a big record, known anyway, to have a chance at being a big record. So we kind of got a kick in the nuts, but it's a really great record, and I really love it when people discover it.
Oh, cool.
That's Tommy Shaw.
Oh my gosh.
You can actually find this on YouTube. The entire record's there for the taking. Yeah. So just type in 10 by 10. Like, I've got it in the search bar there. Number 10, and then times, and then 10, and then Montrose, and you'll find the whole record. There you go. Mike Child loves 10 by 10.
Awesome.
And then you've got tracks on here with, as he said, with Joe Bonamassa, and the list just goes on and on and on. There's some great musicians on that record. I actually looked this up the other day, and I noticed that Ed Roth was playing on the record as well.
Ed Roth was the first guy I contacted, because he and Ronnie were very close, to play keyboards. And he did some great stuff, and he got busy. And my studio finally got finished being developed, and I had my B3 up, so I ended up finishing the record. Edgar Winter, like I said, also does... so the three of us were doing the keyboards on the record, but... It's one of those things that, like, my first instrument was piano. And I don't know, is that your first instrument or not?
Yeah. Piano, and then everything kind of stemmed from there.
I figured it was, because you play piano like somebody who's been playing since they were very young. It's like you're looking at other things, and you're doing pretty intricate stuff. So I figured that was your first instrument. But your guitar playing is pretty, you've come a long way. I've seen some of your stuff.
Oh, cool. Thank you. Well, it's getting there. It's definitely, you know, not at that level yet, but I definitely, and especially playing in the REO tribute, that kind of made me step it up a little bit, because mostly just playing guitar and singing in that one. So
good job, man.
Nice.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I'm definitely, I can't believe it's been all this time, and I'm like, that's been in the back of my head that I needed to check out that album, but I never really have. So I'm definitely going to now. That's so cool.
All right.
What about from you, Dave? A record in your back catalog that you think people should come across and check out?
Well, I don't know. Just first
Jimmy
thing,
Barnes.
Well, Jimmy. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, Jimmy's sometimes like, you play with Jimmy Barnes. Wow. But no, mostly when I say, and I've told some people, like I said, you know, I used to sing background, a lot of backgrounds from Motley Crue, Girls, 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 and Wild Side, and. You know, that Girls record, I sang just, I didn't play a note on guitar. I just played, I was a background singer for Motley Crue, and they said, get out of here. You know, I sang a Girls, Girls, Girls. They said, no, you didn't. I said, yeah, I did. So I just was, you know, just, they don't believe me when I say Girls, you know, Girls, Wild Side, and Decadence. I did a lot of that record too. Primal Scream, Tommy Lee and I sang Scream, Scream, Shout, you know,
I had to leave there. Like Nikki would say, it's the crew, dude. You got to bleed. You know, I left those questions like actually bleeding. My throat.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. So, I don't know.
That's so cool, though. That's something I guess not everybody's going to be aware of, is like on those records, you are singing harmonies, which is so freaking cool that you have a stamp on those classic Motley Crue records, dude.
Yeah, they don't believe, like, get out of here. I'm like, no, okay, I did. Yeah, I did.
Well, that's that question I asked earlier about, you know, are there sessions and records that these guys have been on that you would never know that they're on?
That's right.
A lot of them.
You know,
it's an interesting. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, it's just hard to answer that question because a couple of them, I don't think that the guy knows that I was hired to come in and replace maybe his parts. I'm not real comfortable with that. But
hush.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? It's just like that would be jive. I mean, total jive.
No, I get it. I mean, there are, I think Les Dudek is on a lot of records that a lot of people don't know he's on.
He's a great player.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
sure. Yeah. We did a lot of stuff together, Ricky and I.
That's what I was going to ask. Like, have you two actually been in a band officially together or you know, what have you?
Well, Jonathan Cain's first wife, Jonathan actually kind of called me up one day and said, will you kind of like be the musical director and put this together? And I put all my friends together, which was Dave. And Muggsy was Jonathan's brother. He's always in. Brett Tuggle. And who else was in that band besides Tim Pierce? But after Bruce Gowdy.
Bruce Gowdy, yeah.
And real just good. They were all good friends. And everybody's an amazing musician. And she never got she did do one record. I think we came in after she had done a record with RCA, though. And I don't know. It was just a fun thing for us. It really, more than anything, it didn't blossom into anything. But that was – what else have we been in, David? Besides, I brought David in on – we did a couple television shows with John Parr when it came to
life.
And I've said, I got the guitar player. Don't worry about it, because all of John's people were from in the U.K., and so when he came to Los Angeles, Pat Torpy and I were the bass player and drummer for John Parr during his, when he had the number one song with St. Elmo's Fire. We toured Tina Turner's biggest tour. We opened up for Tina when she had Private Dancer, all those wonderful songs, Thunderdome. As a matter of fact, we were doing a sound check and she came storming out on the stage with her big strut. And she kind of went up to John and says, how dare you? I'm number one, and you knocked me out in first place with St. Elmo's Fire, and it she was just fantastic. She was incredible, but that was a great time. But when we came over to do, what were the TV shows we did, David? It was like late night television, like
Solid Gold for everybody.
We did Solid Gold, but there's another show that you came on to do.
We did Julian Lennon in 85.
Oh, God, that's a great one. You tell that one.
We did Julian Lennon, the first appearance he was on
ever
TV. It was his first single.
Valot,
yeah. And Ricky and I were on the American.
Probably the best drummer in the world, Vinny Caliuta, three-piece behind Julian. Julian was playing keyboards and a little fake harmonica solo. It was the year that Prince didn't talk and everybody had to speak for him. And it was the American Music Awards. If you remember that he for some reason decided, and he had like six people with him. And so they had to speak for him and they were sitting right there.
When was this?
Performing. What year was that? Do you know, Dave?
85. 85.
85?
85. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Were you alive?
Oh, no, I was not born yet.
Yeah, exactly.
No.
The reference goes over Dennis's head.
Oh, what year were you born, Dennis?
97.
Oh, my God. I'm leaving that.
Yeah.
His parents were probably still both virgins at that time, depending on their age.
Oh, my gosh. Anyway. So that's do you even know? Did you ever see Julian Lennon, Dennis? His perform, because he had his career was kind of short lived.
Not really.
He was great. His that lot record was actually very, very good record.
Oh, wait, I think I've just found it. I think I've just found the performance. Let me see. This may be it. I'm not certain, but it's from 1985.
My haircut was magic back then. By the way.
I do just want to quickly say, and this is an important part of my show, and I have to bring it up because it's the only way I can keep this thing going. When I play these clips on the show, every single time I do one of these shows, I get copyright notifications from YouTube and so on and so forth. I can't monetize this stuff at all. So if anybody's enjoying the show and actually wants to donate and contribute to the show to keep this thing going, because I'm trying to do this with as many guests as what we can and give you guys something special. If you are on YouTube or on the Facebook page that I run for this, down in the description, there is a link to a PayPal account. And if you wish to donate anything, I don't force people. I don't have a set amount. I just ask. If you wish to support the show, we'll be very grateful, and thank you very much for that. That's all I'm going to say.
No tote bag?
No, I'm not that organized. But here we go. This, I think, may be the performance. It may not be,
That's it.
May well be. That is it?
Yeah.
That's you guys?
Yeah.
So there's Julian Lennon. I mean, how much does he look like his dad? It's incredible.
Oh, yeah. And he sang like him, too. Yeah.
Let's see if we can find a good shot of you two guys. Look at these guys.
Oh my god. There's a bit of rock history.
How long has it been since you guys have seen this? Ricky on the Pops. Simmons drum
pattern. Actually, yeah, that's a good question. How long has it been since you guys seen this, or like how often do you look back at your stuff that, you know, that happened 20 years ago?
I haven't seen that in 25 years, probably.
I haven't seen that video for a long, long time.
Yeah, that is magical, Ricky. I'm not going to lie to you.
Now, when was the last time you had hair that short, Ricky?
I told you.
Look at that thing.
You guys are both going to be going, well, maybe not you, Jason. But anyway.
Ricky, mine wasn't much better. Let me tell you.
Huh?
Mine wasn't much better.
Ricky could have been, he was moonlighting from his other gig in the Hooters.
Yeah, I was going to say Duran Duran, but the Hooters is just as good.
Oh my God, that's one of those aluminium neck Kramers, isn't it? I just realized that.
Yes.
Good luck keeping that thing in tune.
It was custom made for me. It's a one-off.
Wow. Man, I remember those instruments.
I had it.
What's that?
Was that a Travis Boone?
No, it was Travis Bean was the company before. Kramer, there was two partners, and then somebody split off and did those with the aluminum. It was a wood insert on the back, so it wasn't. Tony Brock made me buy that in Detroit, as a matter of fact. No, not that one. The first one I bought was in Detroit, and he loved the way it sounded. It actually did sound great, and I recorded a lot of the On the Edge record with that bass.
Did that have a real fingerboard on it, or was it that Ebonol stuff, that bowling ball material?
No, it had a real fingerboard.
Oh, okay, yeah.
But it did have the metal neck, but it had a wood insert, which was a huge difference. And that black, that you can't really tell from that footage, but it's kind of a wedge, so it's white and black. And I can't really explain it, but it's a white and black face on it, and it also has a wood insert. And they both sounded great. And you plug them to it to like a SVT, and I don't know what pickups they were, but they were active. It was the first active bass I ever owned. And then Keith Olson, God bless him, he just passed away, was my producer back in those days. And he and I figured out that if you he was kind of a scientist in his own right. And he realized that those active bases should probably have 2 9-volt batteries rather than just the one. So what we did is we backed it off. There were no numbers, but let's say 10 to about 8.5 or 9, just back off a little bit. And then you could crank it as much as you wanted, and you'd get this really warm, gritty rock and roll tone. So my tone on the second record, that with the babies, although something about Union Jacks is a soft spot. And I recorded that with a 68 Tele bass. It sounds great, but there's some edge that I didn't have with this active bass. And that's what that one is. Very akin to. The two of them are very much alike.
Do you find those aluminum neck basses had more of a round sound, but almost like you've got that notch, you know what I mean? That frequency notch because of the metal versus really wood resonating.
Incredible for getting heard in a record and staying in the mix. That was always my mission. Right. It wasn't almost like this is my favorite bass sound, but it'll never, on a big rock record, it'll never cut through. When I discovered Spectre basses, those basses were brilliant. It's like butter on a rock and roll. Bad English records, all of that is with Spectre basses. And those records to me sound amazing. The mixer, Mike Frazier, was able to crank me up in the mix because it didn't wash out any of the guitars, didn't wash out any of background vocals or anything else. And that's a big part of getting beyond your art as just, well, this is me and I do this. You've got to figure out, how do I get me on those records? How do I get me so that the mix is friendly? And so I was driven a bit by that, other than my fix for old Gibsons and Fenders. That's another mission. But being on a record and getting those tones so they sound rock and roll. And right, Dave, you know what I'm saying, right?
Oh, yeah.
I found that bass tone and Forget Me Not really, like, on a good stereo system just separates nicely and adds, like, it surrounds you without having a surround system.
I had the very first 5-string Spectre bass ever made. It was stolen. Three of my favorite basses were stolen. We were going in to do the second Bad English record, and they loaded everything into a truck, and unfortunately, they stole the truck that night. Someone stole the truck.
My God.
There's another story about all that, because I found out a guy that had one of the basses, but nevertheless, I lost him, man. But that was the very first 5-string Spectre ever made that I did Forget Me Not with.
And then I think you borrowed one from Bruce.
Bruce gave me his black one.
Bruce had one, yeah.
And Jason Sheff gave me a couple. And, oh, gosh, forgive me, whoever you are. Somebody else gave me. I had, because we were in the next morning. The truck's gone, stolen. All of our gear, Jonathan Kane's gear, Neil Sean guitars, all my amps, SBTs. And we were recording the next morning. So, guys were coming out of the woodwork to help us out so we could get on with it. And we did. And that's a great sounding record too. So we just got fortunate to have people help us out in getting that record started off.
Sorry, which record was that? Because I just returned.
We were talking about his bass sound on the first Bad English record. Well, I referenced the first one, and then he said the second one, just the same thing.
Yeah, the first Bad English record was all my Spectres and no problem. And then when they were stolen, on the night before we started the second record, we had some fancy footwork going on to get started down at Conway to do that record. And it ended up being, I love the sound of it too. And I keep bringing up the name Mike Frazier. Mike Frazier mixed those records. There were times when I would hear rough mixes of things and I go, I don't know. But Mike Frazier, in Bad English, I was the only one who was there for every day for the mixes of that second record. And I watched Mike and learned so much from him. He also did the Coverdale Page record that I did. He mixed and recorded us on that one as well.
I want to ask about that in a second. But before we move away from Bad English, check this out. This is when I very first was aware of Ricky.
Oh, there you go.
How's the energy on this? This is it. I've watched this so many times. God. I saw this live when it happened on TV and recorded on VHS. Go, Dean. What the hell is with that suit? Red plastic. I mean, come on.
Yeah. But he can pull it off.
No shit. And what a voice. Oh my God.
Again, another one of those guys that got sort of pigeonholed because of the pop ballad. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Doesn't quite get its deserved.
I love this pre-chorus bridge in this song. This is so good.
Castronovo is just going off in this song.
Bass player never gets a lot of camera time. Have you noticed that?
There you go.
There you go.
You guys just so bought your A game on this.
But it was an underrated band.
What really cracks me up with this one is poor Neil. Mid guitar solo. Was it solo or just a lick? I can't remember. I think it was in the solo here. He snaps the string. Oh, no, he's already changed. He's already There you go. It happens just here. Here we go. There you go.
Swap the guitar. Give me a guitar swap, quick.
This is the problem with using a locking tremolo on your guitar, folks. Here we go. It just happened. Here we go. I think you see it. Here it comes. You can hear it's out of tune. Runs away.
Yep. Quickly.
Very smart way to continue going, just holding notes. Testimony of the band to keep going. You can see his broken string right there. And that he comes
nobody,
with the yellow one.
Acknowledges it.
No. That is true professionalism right there. Man, I love this song.
You know, when you've got a great keyboard player too that can add another layer there, when that guitar goes away, you can drop, you know, hang on a sting there. For that changeover,
we were on the road for 11 months. Our first single, Forget Me Not, did okay, but it was too heavy. It was too hard. We got all these calls from, like, I remember it was with Sammy and I guess Sammy and Eddie Van Halen were in the back of a car, and they heard it and they called Neil immediately. And I happened to be sitting next to Neil. They were, what the, you know, they loved it. But it was just too heavy. And so we put out,
No Such Thing.
When I See You Smile. and it went boom to number one, you know, and I didn't even, I love Diane Warren, but I wanted this just to be a rock band. Didn't really want singles, and it was not my favorite track, but John Waite told me, he said, you got to bet me on this. I'll make this a number one song. And he was a man of his word. He certainly did.
Wow.
Yeah, that song was huge. Although, with Best of What I Got, I still remember watching Tango and Cash, and when that comes on the opening credits, I was just sitting there rocking out with the song, and it was really cool placement in that film, too.
Yeah, I like that, too.
Such a great movie.
I'm sure Kurt Russell called Ricky and said, hey, can I get your hair cut from about 3 years ago?
Yeah.
What the heck did you guys do to your hair in the 80s and 90s? That's what I want to know.
How did I what?
What did you do to your hair in
Say
the
again?
80s and 90s?
What didn't I do to my hair?
How do you even do that? I don't even get that.
Aquanet. Yeah. It was like any color of dye we can get. Let's try this, and let's try this, and let's cut this off, and let's do this.
Yep.
You know, it was just trying to figure out, I don't know if I was trying to figure out anything. I'd see something and dig it and go for it.
Mm-hmm. There you go. I have a question, because you guys talk so much about guitars, and actually the guitarist Rick Hunter we were talking about, he's going to get me a new guitar, because I use this beat up old, like, it's a Fender, but it's not a real Fender, it's like a copycat, you know, and he says he's going to buy me a guitar, and I can't, like, think of which guitar I want to get, what I want to get next that's really going to get the job done. But I want something with a lot of character, and I personally feel like I would use a whammy bar a lot, but, you know, it's a hard thing to decide. Like, if I can get one guitar, my first, like, real, you know.
Tell Dave what it is you want this guitar to do, because I know your whammy bar fits your personality. Let me just put that out there.
Shameless plug.
But what is it you
there
want?
There you go.
Dave Amato Signature Series Gibson Custom Shop.
Which normally, under normal circumstances, is sacrilegious to put a trem on a Les Paul, but yes, it works on Dave's.
Wow. Okay.
Mind you, though, how much there is that guitar going to set a 22-year-old kid back?
Yeah, that's the question.
Well,
This is, I think, $5,000. But okay. I don't know what it is in stores. I don't know.
It's more than my keyboard.
If I may, because I spent 15 years of my life working in retail doing exactly what it is that you're asking for here, working in guitar shops and selling guitars to kids and trying to help them get started with their careers. I'll tell you right now, my personal advice is if you want a locking tremolo guitar, pick yourself up, and it's not just because I play Ibanez guitars, it's just a thing as far as affordability goes, right? If you want to get yourself something that's good, that's under $1,000, pick yourself up a late 80s, early 90s Ibanez guitar that's still in good condition, because you can pick them up for anywhere from $500 to $1,000. They got locking tremolos, they got humbuckers with the ability to split coils to go single coil for when you want Fender sounds, and when you want Gibson sounds, you go humbuckers. When you want Fender sounds, you go single
coil. And you
coils.
Get a tremolo.
And you get a locking tremolo that stays in tune like no man's business.
One of the greatest guitars you can find for under $1,000, and they pop up every once in a while, is an Ibanez Gem 505.
Yeah, and they're not too bad at all. But you want to get a Japanese.
That sounds pretty cool.
Yes. The 505 is Japanese. It's got a maple neck. It's not scalloped. It's got a, you know, it's your basic, but it's got all of the things that you want in a premium guitar for under $1,000. It's the greatest steal that you can find.
But
if you can find
trick.
One.
Yeah, the big trick is with 80s Ibanez guitars and 90s Ibanez guitars, even still to this day, that is the tremolo system that you want on the guitar, right? It's called an Ibanez Edge, and it stays in tune like no other tremolo in the world.
As opposed to what?
They do make Indonesian-made guitars that have trems. See, like what Dave's got there is an original Floyd Rose on his guitar.
Okay.
But as much as what I want to help promote Dave's guitar to you, that guitar is not so cheap, which is the issue you're going to suffer.
Well, right? I think
but
when I'm
a guitar
the,
like
you
that,
know.
That tremolo-wise is going to do it for you. I mean, to get this exact guitar here, this is a rare guitar and is a hard one to come by and would cost you way too much money. But as far as getting yourself something with that tremolo system, that's going
to
do it.
Ibanez is the way to go with on that.
Well, I mean, I'm an Ibanez guy through and through, and I'm not saying it just because of that, but as far as like you trying to get something within your price point that's going to do it for you, that's why I say that.
Or the Charvel Pro Mods. The Charvel Pro Mods are really good too. You can find one of those used.
Make a plug too. You know what? Epiphone, you know, for under $1,000, Epiphone is making some great guitars, man. And they're, you know, they're Gibson, and the Epiphone's really good, man. You got Les Pauls and...
Do they make one with a trem in it, though? You know, with a
I'm pretty
a
sure. Whammy.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering.
I'm trying to put my first one here. I'm trying to have Epiphone make, you know, this first one of mine, just single pick, you know, single pickup, a volume tone, you know, pull tone switch with the Floyd. I'm trying to have Epiphone make this one.
That'd be great. Have them put an FR-1000 on it and,
that'd be awesome.
Less than $1,000.
Yeah,
that'd be killer.
It'd be great. So, I don't know. I'm trying to work on that, but everything's in lockdown right now. Everything's in lockdown.
And you know, it's like once I get, I think, to the next level. Like, if it were a keyboard, or if it was I'm looking into getting a new laptop, which also goes along with producing and being a keyboard player. That's something where I could really imagine already spending a lot of money on. But it's like right now, getting my my first nice guitar, you know, I think that's, cause I want to get a 7-string and I want to get a 12-string and, you know, yeah.
You
I mean, I want to
get yourself one of
that.
These babies.
I'd love to get a Music Man. I've played one of those at NAMM. Wow. Those are awesome. There's so many things I want to get.
Way go, Jan Hammer.
I thought Ricky would get a laugh out of seeing a keytar on the show.
Keytar.
That is great.
Cheetah.
Look at that.
Yeah.
I remember when I saw Dragon Force years ago when first came out, and the idea that a band like that would come out and a guy whips out, I think Herman Lee had the keytar on. I was like, you got to be kidding me. What are you doing? And it was awesome. It was great. And everybody's jaws hit the floor. The keytar was a moment. Oh, wait, is Ricky going to get one?
I don't know.
It'd be great if he came back.
We've been on the show for a while. Ricky's probably there trying to negotiate how much more time he's got left before we have to stop the show. And I can't blame him because, like, you know, what is it in Nashville now? It's, I think, 9:34 p.m. or something.
Probably, yeah. This has been 2.5 hours.
Ricky, do you need to run, mate? Oh, no. He's getting more wine.
Wine,
just
Ryan.
Getting more wine.
You're all good now.
He thought you were coming with a keyboard or something.
Yeah, we thought you were coming with a guitar.
I was running out of gas. I'm good now.
Ricky was getting, because I mean, in true style of Dave and Ricky, he'd be like, "Here, hold." As we have an Australian saying, "Here, hold my beer," and the dude disappears and comes back with something that completely annihilates you, like you know, with like a triple stack.
No, no, no. I wish I could have. No, no keytar. No.
I won the round. Woohoo!
You did.
Now. While we're talking about guitar collections here, because you guys showed me this the other day, Ricky, do you want to bring on your Firebird that Dave wishes he owned?
Oh, I'd love to. I will say Dave's 64 is very nice. Hold on.
Yeah, you mean Dave's 64 is pretty good because Ricky owns an original.
It's nice, but it's not the first year and the first 80 million. Yeah. It's the second year. Oh, wait a minute. I got to get this. Here we go.
Ricky owns an original 1963 Firebird first year issue, folks. Like, that is insane to come across a guitar like that.
Yeah.
Here, let's get.
I was so jealous of that for years. Years.
He can use that to defend himself if somebody breaks out of the house.
I must have 20 pictures of Clapton playing this with the cream in the end, and then with. John Lennon, I think, maybe it's the Plastic Ono Band or something.
Yeah.
That particular guitar?
No, not. I wish. God, I wish. But this, there were only 80 of these made. So I've been told. If anybody's out there that can correct me on that, and these, you know, hockey stick headstocks broke. If I look at it too long, it'll break. So I'm wondering how many of these are of the 80 are left. And a guy that I was buying guitars from, he was in Oregon, and he said, "Look, this thing never had a case. It's been leaned. I've since got the case from the year for it, from that buddy of yours, Dave. He found it for me.
Oh,
the guy in Michigan or Wisconsin or wherever he's from.
Bruce
Hastell.
Yeah, Bruce Hastell.
Bruce Hastell found me a case, but this guitar has." Everybody I hand it to, and I say, just play it, because it's not for everything. But what it does with this one pickup, with all this expansive area of wood to resonate through, and also it's a neck through.
Yeah.
Oh, it's got a mojo to it that is just freaking sick. And like I said, it's not for everything, but if you like the blues, I mean, if Billy Gibbons walked in right now, I'd hand it to him, and he would want to steal it. It's just really, really cool.
I wanted to steal it for 10 years.
I know. If anybody stole it,
I just found a picture. There's Clapton in the corner with his.
Hey, baby.
It's a huge guitar, you know, for on somebody like Clapton.
You know what I have to say, though?
Yeah.
This could be research. I think that's a 64. I think Clapton's was not a 63. I think it was.
You could be right. You could be right.
Well, it says here 63/65. So, yeah, it's highly possible.
Yeah, you could be right. His could be a 64. I agree. I've looked at his, matter of fact, and it looks, I don't know why it looks different, but it looks different.
I think it's funny, when the Explorer came out and it failed originally, they just sort of made it bigger and sort of tried again, took another shot at it, with the Firebird. And that one stuck.
Well, there's Joe Bonamassa with potentially three of them.
Now, Joe didn't have one when I went to pick him up at his hotel to do the 10x10 record. Because I had told him, I said I had one, and that was dead silence. So I think he maybe, I could be wrong. I'm going to have to ask him next time I see him. But I don't think he had one when, how long ago was that? God, it's been a few years now.
But hang on, it says here, limited 2016 limited edition Joe Bonamassa signature Firebird.
Yes.
But he's got an old one, I think. I think I read that he does have.
Oh, I'm sure he does, yeah.
So that's all he does is get old ones.
He's got everything.
I'd love to say that he's been sitting here waiting for the last 2 hours and 38 minutes to jump on the show and prove you wrong, but unfortunately I don't have Joe Bonamassa's contact.
Jason, can I tell you? Joe gave me one of his reissues. The Epiphone ones.
Really?
That's the one in the video that he's talking about there. You didn't tell me he gave you that. That's so cool.
Great. I bet it does. How's it sound?
Oh, it sounds amazing. I love the pop. I just left it stock. It's amazing.
Epiphone. When did this start? Like a year ago? Epiphone has turned it around, man. They are.
I'm saying to Dennis, Epiphone, check out some Epiphones, man. They're really making some good stuff.
I know.
But with the Epiphones, right. I have to say, make sure you buy a new one as far as like what's out now. Yes. Because yes. Before,
oh, okay.
So as you probably
I
heard,
have a friend who has an older one.
Well, this is the issue, right? A couple of years ago, Gibson basically, not basically, factually, just kicked their owner out of the company. Henry was just going absolutely insane and making some terrible decisions on behalf of the company. He was literally running it into the ground. And a lot of people still can't figure out what the hell is going on. But the point is, since it's been taken over and there's new management involved and everything, the company's direction has really changed, and they've brought things up a massive notch from where they were. So,
which is interesting because the guy that runs the company now used to be the head of Levi's.
Yes, it's JC. I know him. He's a wonderful guy, and
he loved guitars, which is great.
Absolutely, definitely, yes. And he wanted to make they both did wanted to make Gibson great again, like. They were in the past, they didn't want to put electronic tuners on them. Remember they had self-tuning. No, it was horrible. Yeah. So now, they're making the stuff that we love, that we know Gibson, SGs and Les Pauls and Firebirds and good stuff. All the good stuff that Gibson, made before. Cool. And they're great. Really great.
That's cool.
So definitely get yourself something from Gibson that, as far as Epiphone, if you're going to do that, that was made either last year or this year. Preferably this year, if you can get your hands on it, even if you have to wait a little bit for stocks to start going back through. And that's definitely a good way to go.
You know, Tommy Shaw lives in Nashville, and he was the first one to hit me because he's like Dave. He's got to go there. And he knows the people, and he's one that told me, he goes, oh my gosh, you got to see what Epiphone's making out. He went in there and started plugging things in, and it was just like, going, wait a minute. It really, really turned it around.
Yeah. Well, they're doing that Inspired By series now, which is essentially the only difference is there's just a little difference in the headstock, but the wood is a better quality wood, and they're putting American pickups in them now and really doing the difference between a premium Epiphone and the low end Gibson is it's almost the premium Epiphone is actually a superior guitar now. Better finishing, the difference is polyester versus nitro. That's really become the only difference now is the painting.
Okay, so question for all y'all, because I don't know this. What is the difference between that? I mean, what's the difference in the paint?
What's more expensive?
Well, no, nitro takes longer to apply. It takes days to apply. They got to do it sheet by sheet. And over time, it dissipates and allows the wood to breathe, whereas polyester seals it and it stays the same no matter what. So you never get that that change of the aging, where the guitar gets a more sweeter sound later on. And that's essentially what it is. Now, that said, most of the tonal differences, and Dave, please correct me if I'm wrong, most of the tonal differences when recording can be adjusted through post EQ.
Yeah. No, Paul, that was not nicely said. The pickups they've stepped up the pickups, and I mean, just making them really. I mean, the action. Before some of the Epiphones were like, some kiddie, but now they're making them really pro, man. These Epiphones, really, the Les Pauls are phenomenal. The paint
job. What did happen a lot, though, with a lot of those Epiphones, particularly in the mid to late 2000s, I mean, we had so many issues with this when I was working in stores in Australia with it, is that the headstocks would unfortunately snap really, really, really easily on that stuff at that particular period of time. And they weren't something in the wood consistency it was just so much of an issue. So that's why I'm recommending to get something new if you can find it, if that's the way you want to go.
I have a question for David. Are you using your Ronnie Montrose Les Paul?
Yes.
Are you using it live or in the studio?
Live.
You are?
Yeah, I have it out live. It's a phenomenal guitar. You and I know Don Felder. He's good friends of ours.
Yeah.
They reissued the Don Felder, the double neck, and they just made a spectacular job of emulating his or copying his. And same thing with the Montrose. It is, since it's about 300 of them, I think they made, Ricky.
Yeah.
And
Yeah, so they stopped at 280 or something like that.
Okay, yeah, 280. And I luckily I got my hands on him from one of my buddies. He just wanted to sell it. I thought he was insane to sell it, but he said that you should have it, you know. So
I want one.
Oh, they're amazing. What amazing job the custom shop did on the Ronnie Montrose. I mean, it looks the same. It's got all the scratch marks. You know, the back of the neck is worn down, and it sounds phenomenal. It's, yeah, I have that out in the road. I use it in a couple songs.
Cool.
Yeah. Great, great guitar. Incredible. So
very sweet. Hey, Dave, when we were asking before about how you guys got started, Ricky got to tell us his story about how he got into Styx, but we never got your story about how you ended up in REO Speedwagon.
Wow. Well, like a mutual friend of Ricky and I, Jesse Harms, who used to play keyboards in Sammy Hagar.
He was living with me in Los Angeles. His song became a song, turned more into a songwriter, and he was living with me in my house in Los Angeles, kind of figuring out if he wanted to stay there, go back to San Francisco. And then he and Dave became good friends. And
he got to be a staff writer for Geffen. And, you know, he'd write all these songs, but he wasn't really a guitar player. So he would just call me and I'd do most of his demos, really, you know, just, you know, songwriting demos. He'd get paid, you know.
We were cheap.
Huh?
I said we were cheap.
Yeah. Exactly.
I don't believe that for a second. I've seen your guitar collections. That's not possible.
No, I mean we would play on his demos and he didn't have to pay us.
We get a sandwich or something, you know.
Right.
So he paid me back though. So he started writing when Rich Rath had left REO Speedwagon. Kevin was looking for another, you know, writer to fill that hole, you know. So Jesse, I believe that Kevin's wife worked at Geffen too, she hooked Jesse up with Kevin to write some songs. And of course, I was mostly played on Jesse's demo. So Kevin said, "Hey, well, you know, we need some guitar on these tracks that we're writing." So Jesse said, "You know, Amato does all my demos. He's a good guy, and you know, I guess a good player, and he, you know, liked what I did." So I went in on like a Friday, and I played like two of, you know, like "Keep on Loving You." They played two, you know, classic REO songs, and then some of the new songs that they were writing. I just put my two cents in, and I guess they liked what I did. So I went in there like 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and by five they asked me to join the band.
Wow, nice.
Like, okay, sure, great. But the funny story was, I had auditioned for Cher like for months and months and months, like at least three, four months. And I kept getting called back, and you wouldn't hear anything for 3 weeks. And then all of a sudden, oh, Cher wants you to come. Manager would call here, come. And I got the Cher gig on a Wednesday after all these months.
I remember this.
Yeah. I got the
Cher. I remember you coming to me and going, what am I going to do?
I got the Cher gig on a Wednesday from 3 or 4 months of auditioning with Cher. You know, everybody in town auditioned for Cher. Everybody in the world in Los Angeles.
Good money, that's what.
Yeah, and I got the gig on a Wednesday. So, and Friday I was supposed to go audition, you know, for REO. So I was relaxed. I had already got the gig. I swear to God, I got the gig on a Wednesday. So Friday I was like, I'll go out and play with REO. And dude, I guess I was, you know, I wasn't like uptight or nervous or anything. So I just went in and did my thing. And then I said, I called Ricky and said, now what do I do? I got two gigs in the same week. It was crazy.
Well, look at history. I mean, if history says anything, you made the right choice.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, here's the question. Are you guys at the point now where you don't audition? Where like you wouldn't have to. Like, I mean, obviously both bands are doing well, but you're in a position where people come to you. You have the right. You could just turn this stuff down now, right? You just kind of go,
I wouldn't audition. I wouldn't audition, but it isn't because I'm trying to be arrogant. It's like there's enough things, really good, well-recorded things. You know exactly what I'm like.
Right.
I don't want to go through it. It's an emotional thing to audition. I think of myself sitting in that hallway, listening to the guy that's in there right now, thinking, oh, God, he's pretty good. You know, and, you know, it's a very weird, invasive, emotionally sort of thing. Dennis, right. You're doing the right thing by always running your own band. It's to go.
Well, I know the feeling from acting auditions. It's the same thing. It's that's even crazier because it's like with a band, maybe you audition 5 or 6 people. With acting jobs here in LA, it's like you go in for a commercial for like a 15-second slot where you say one line, and the way you say that one line is being compared to the way literally 150 or 300 other people are saying that one line. Hmm. And you're just like hearing them in the room next, you know, and it's like, oh, I wasn't saying it like that. It's mind blowing. So yeah, I could imagine like once you've gotten to this point in your career, why do you want to like keep having to prove yourself like that?
What about you,
it's my trip.
I think with Ricky or me, I mean, not that we're doing a lot of auditions now. We have our own. We're not busy right this second, but we're so busy with, you know, his Styx and REO, and we tour all year long, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
But I think if somebody wanted us to play on their record or whatever, you know, or guest on something, they know what Ricky does. I mean, you know, they know what I do. You know, it's not a question. They're picking Ricky for Ricky. He knows what I want Ricky because I like the way he plays. I want him for this spot. So, you know, we don't really have to, you know.
When did that happen? When did you get to the point where you were comfortable saying, okay, I'm at a position where I can pick and choose my thing? Because there are guys that have been around for, you know, decades that are not household names that still do have to do studio work and session work and stuff like that. When did that happen? But around what point did that happen when you went, all right, I'm good?
Well, not until Bad English, really, because there was a 10-year gap between The Babies and Bad English. So I was just doing sessions. And thank God the producers I had worked for in my bands, The Babies and other things, maybe I was trying to get off the ground, went, oh, wow, you're my guy now. You're my guy. So I wasn't working like every day or anything, but I had enough I was still chasing. I always call it, the Hollywood shuffle. You're just trying to get through and figure out, you know, what gig and taking this and taking that. And there was a lot of stuff that was crap that I wasn't really excited about doing, but I needed the bread.
Yeah.
When Jonathan Cain came to me and said, look, I want to do something, Journey splitting up. Let's do something. I want to be ready, blah, blah, blah. And then we had a whole other thing in mind with what we were going to do entirely. And then he ran into Wait in New York because he had just produced Michael Bolton's Dock of the Bay record. And he was going to New York for something. Ran into Wait, they had dinner. He calls me up and said, Wait wants in on what we're doing. And so let's fly to New York. Let's fly to San Francisco where Jonathan was living because of being in Journey. And let's see if we still have the magic. Let's see if we have the chemistry. And I mean, the first 5 songs we wrote in a couple of days were just so good that I was kind of going, oh my God, because Jonathan and John, they're so good and they're so strong that it ends up being this battle that I knew would eventually happen, and it did. But we got 2 good records in, and before that completely fell apart. But that's kind of, I think when you've got people who are really strong-willed and to be as good as they are, they probably get that by not listening or falling prey to what somebody else wants to do. Both might be good, but that's what ends up happening. And I've witnessed it with people who are so good at what they do. It's very hard for them to kind of lean in another direction because they know, no, this is my strength. And it's almost in a paranoia to do that. So after Bad English, when we did eventually split up, I was kind of like, okay, I've got some really good records. If you want to know what I sound like, listen to that. Otherwise, I don't want to be drugged through the dirt because I've seen people vacillate and drag you on and try this guy, try that, and then come back. Well, you want? No, I was just done with it. I emotionally couldn't even think of it.
Hmm. I think for me, it was probably the 90s. I think just one thing. It was I was playing with Cher and Richie Sambora, you know, Bon Jovi was humongous. I mean, you know, they were just unbelievable.
Yeah.
Richie was going out with Cher at the time, and he used to come, you know, on the side of the stage because he was off tour then, so he was dating her, and you know, so he'd watch me play every night, and And then he came up to me one night and he said, you know, hey, Dave, I'm just finishing up a solo record and I want you to come on tour with me, you know? And I went, yeah, okay, sure, you know, yeah, right, you know. He says, no, really, you know, like, okay, you know, well, give me a call, you know? So about a month later, he finished the record, whatever it was, you know, and then he gave me a call. He said, you're going to New Jersey, let's go, you know? And when I got there, who was in the band but Tico, Dave, you know, Richie and me. And it was like, wow. You know, whoa, what, you know, it was the whole Bon Jovi band.
And Tony Levin.
And Tony Levin on bass, yes.
Wow.
Yeah, and I just went, you know, wow, what am I doing here, you know? But, hey, I was there and I did it. And I think that was the moment for me. I went like, you know what?
Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, I passed the test, you know.
That's validation and a half right there.
Yeah, that was a whole Bon Jovi band I played with, really.
Wow.
I love those guys. And another thing I wanted to just add to Ricky as far as auditioning and stuff like that. Yeah, I think, see, Ricky, I know Ricky, we're friends for years, but Ricky's a good guy. People want good people with them, you know, and Ricky's got a great reputation for a great player, and he's a great guy to get along with. And that's half the battle in a band. You know, if you're an asshole, I don't care how good you play, you don't want you in the band. You know, you're not going to get along. You're going to have friction. But Ricky gets along with any. You can tell he's a great guy.
Well, same with you. It's the same with most of the guys we know that are in our bands. I mean, whenever there's somebody who's just full of themselves and thinks that they're their own biggest fan, they're probably not going to do well in a band situation. Something's going to happen, and I've seen it all, and it's I respect the chemistry on certain people who have maybe got this side to them. It's like and I've done records, and I kind of can go there if I really love the person's talent and artistry, but I couldn't be in a band anymore with somebody like that. I can't.
Yeah.
No.
It's amazing to me when I see you guys in these bands for, you know, 20 years or something, and people really underestimate it. And you see all these, you know, comments on Facebook and YouTube, and, you know, they're going like, they're calling you guys the new guys, or, you know, comparing you to the old ones. And it's like, or they think that there's been a million members in the band when Styx has had 10 members since 1970, I think, or 71. And REO, it's about the same thing, right? Like 10 people ever, nine people or something like that. My tribute band to Styx in the past 4 years has had like twice as many members as that. That's how hard it is to keep a band together. And it's like, you don't realize how long, you know, a year of playing 150 shows really is until you play two shows over the course of, you know, 2 weeks of rehearsal, how much it really takes to get along with
So here is a perfect example of that. All right. I've got an absolutely perfect example. Deep Purple. Great band. We all know Deep Purple well.
Love them.
You look at Deep Purple's history as far as their band lineup goes and as far as the members of the band goes, and here is an absolute perfect example. All right. The current lineup has Steve Morse, legendary guitar player, has been in the band since 1994. It is still in the band right now. So that's 26 years he's been in the band. Richie Blackmore, who everyone still does this with Deep Purple, 1968 to 1975. So there's 8 years, 7 years right there. And then rejoined 1984 to 1993. There's another 9 years there, right? So that's 17, 18 years worth of being in the band versus Steve Morse, who's been in the band for 26 years. And yet people will still, and Steve Morse is just one of the greatest guitar players ever lived.
Yeah.
People will look at Deep Purple as Richie Blackmore, and they won't let it go. It's just the way fans can be.
Have you guys heard Flying Colors? The Steve Morse with Mike Portnoy.
Yeah.
Oh my God. That's great stuff.
Neil Morse is insane.
He's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, anyway, look, I'm going to have to wrap this thing up shortly because I'm sure that as much as what Dave and Ricky are polite, they're probably going to be busting to get off this thing because we're almost about to hit 3 hours on the show.
Yeah.
Dennis, I'm going to start by letting you go, mate. And then
thanks so much for having me.
You bet, Dennis.
You've been a champion. Thanks for sticking around. And it's great that you and Ricky have a pre-existing relationship and that you still, in your younger generation, fly the flag for these two fantastic bands and musicians. So good job, dude.
Yeah, nice one. Nice one.
Hey, Dennis, I'll see you around. See you in the neighborhood.
Yeah. Sounds good. Thank you guys for being so cool. I mean, it's one thing to love these bands, but to have this personal relationship and you guys are so cool. It's, you know, it's mind blowing. I love it. And thanks for having me on. So
I know you'll carry that. Cool. Thanks.
Okay. Bye.
There's a great comment right there.
Yeah, exactly. Ronnie Wood is still the new guy. And it's so true. It's just a harsh thing with the way fans just, I don't know, like some of them are very, as we've seen tonight, some of them are very, very, very embracing of the fans, the newer members, and some of them just can't seem to let it go.
Yeah, but then you get a guy like Dennis who doesn't give a shit. Like he's just into the band, into the music. And you know, again, when you got Dave has been there and Ricky has been there for so long, and Ricky's in a different situation. We talked about this a little bit earlier in the show. Ricky's in a different situation because Rich Rath is never coming back, whereas Chuck is still around and still part of the family. And you know, the only other band that I know that the two other bands I know that have done that. I mean, obviously Def Leppard stuck with Rick Allen, and with Mr. Big stuck with Pat Torpey when he was sick as well. You know, that is the epitome of class. And I'm certainly not diminishing what Dave is doing in REO at all, but it's sort of a different environment. Fans sometimes can't let go of the old, and it's even more difficult, and Ricky should be commended for that, to be in a situation where that umbrella is a little bit bigger because that member is still there.
Well, thank you. I mean, I didn't know how that was going to be. I didn't know how Chuck was. When I first joined the band, Chuck was really not doing well, so he wasn't around that much. And then all of a sudden, he started coming back more and more. Now he does almost every show. So he and I had time to kind of figure that out. And once he realized who I was and that I was not, I was welcoming and you know, you do what you can do, and I'll do the rest. I'll do the heavy lifting, you know. And once he knew I was a team member. Now Chuck and I are very, very close, and he's a lovely guy, really lovely guy. He's seen a lot, done a lot. He wrote a book, The Grand Illusion, and it's interesting because it's about being a gay man in a very heterosexual, sexual rock and roll environment, and trying to be quiet about it, and not realizing all the guys know, and they still love you. No, don't worry about it. And the brotherhood, because his twin brother, Johnny, was the amazing drummer in Styx that came up with all those cool, he was perfect. He was perfect for the band coming up in that time. And then the band, we're talking about new members, Dave and I, we called a new guy, Todd Zuckerman. Wow, what a find that was to come in when Johnny passed away. And it's just been, they've done really well. I mean, both bands have managed adversity so well and brought in the right people that needed to be there, personality-wise, like Dave was alluding to, and talent. And getting lucky in both regards. Like, well, not lucky, I think that they waited and made their chess game moves appropriately when they needed to be made. And I think that's why Dave and I have the great fortune of being in two of those bands that are probably rarefied air. You know, Dave, I could work with Dave till the end of my days. I could work with Styx, but there's not a whole lot of people that I would add beyond that. I mean, it's really, really just a fortunate, you know, music has been a blessing in my life, and I know it's been the same in Dave's.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It's been a great ride for me, and I know Ricky, you too. Is what a ride we've been on, you know. So really, great.
Dave, I think it's important for you. It's important for you to tell Kevin that hearing it from a friend who hears it from a friend who hears it from a friend is inadmissible in court. So you know.
But to reiterate to Ricky's point earlier.
What's that?
Sorry, I was going to say to reiterate to Ricky's own point himself earlier. You two are a perfect testament of exactly what Ricky said. The greatest talent in the world doesn't mean everything. Being able to get along and be a good dude is what makes it work. And you two are definitely testaments to that fact of the matter. I mean, you know, you're both such really nice, easygoing dudes. and yet have talent up the yin yang, and well done, very well deserved. That's why you are there doing what you're doing and still doing it.
No, thank you.
No, thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
I think it's the biggest mistake that up and coming musicians make is like they get a small, like just that tiny little bit of success, whether it's in their local scene or whatever, and all of a sudden it goes to their heads and they blow up and become idiots. And I mean, you know, this show is called Live Streams with Famous Friends for a reason. I've got a lot of them, and those famous dudes out there who've done really well for themselves 99% of the time are really good, nice people, and they're quite humble about it too, which is great.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, yeah. You've got to, if you're in a band, man, you've got to be, you know, married. You're married to this guy. I've been with my guys for 31 years and Ricky's 17, 31 years. That's like, wow. You know,
and it really is that 4 or 5 way marriage. It really is. Anybody that's ever been in a band will tell you that it's you can't serve two masters, and the band tends to be a master. It's very difficult. And to be honest with you, you know, your significant others are better than we are because they put up with not only dealing with you and the lifestyle that you've chosen, but also the other 4 wives that you have.
Mm. Yeah, sure.
That's true. The girlfriends and wives definitely get forgotten about a lot as far as the amount of support. I mean, even my wife has to support me doing this show for a few hours every day to be able to, you know, take care of the kids and what have you going on with this current situation that we're living in. So, yeah, there's no question. And, I mean, both of your partners jumped in the other night and helped you guys. It was so funny when we set all this up. The two girls were running around doing all the computer stuff and Ricky and Dave were sitting there going, I have no idea what I'm doing. That was hilarious.
You fix this whole thing for me. I mean, this, I don't know what happened to this one. And then she's like, oh, well, while I'm on this one, set up that one. So she set up that one for me. This is crazy.
Oh, yeah.
Charity and effort.
And 2 phone books. I got 2 phones. Ah, oh, please, come on.
Well, look, gentlemen, thank you so much for your time. I am going to sign off the show now. I'm going to play a little bit of music to get us out of the show, but please stick around in the background for a second. I'll talk to you guys in a moment.
Okay.
Paul, thank you very much for joining me when Dave couldn't make it to this show. I know that Dave was crushed because Dave is a huge fan of Todd's as a drummer. Dave, my regular co-host, is a drummer himself, and he loves Todd's drumming. He's a big, big, big fan of what Todd does. So, but anyway, look, gentlemen, thank you so much. Folks, I'm going to leave you with a classic Styx number. We came into the show with REO. We're going to leave with an absolute true and utter. My favorite Styx song, without a shadow of a doubt, is Renegade. And thanks for watching the show. Please, if you haven't already, like the Facebook page, subscribe to the YouTube channel, and come back because there's plenty more episodes going. Tomorrow night, Australian time, so 8 p.m. Melbourne time, I have a classic Australian band called The Paw, who have just been out doing a AC/DC Back in Black from start to finish tribute show. And they're a famous Australian band, but they're doing that because their singer can sing like Brian Johnson better than even on Brian Johnson's best day. It's ridiculous. So anyway, there's going to be plenty more coming. As I said, Diesel's coming up. I've got Hailstorm on the show next week and a whole lot more. So check out the website. Thanks again to Ricky and Dave. Thank you again to Paul. And we'll see you all again on the show soon. Thanks, guys.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.